Before we get to all of that, we've got to do a little bit of a show, right? We can't just go into the trailer immediately. That would be ridiculous, right? That would be stupid, right? So we're gonna have to warm up a little bit, guys. Go ahead and tell your friends, right? Even on YouTube, go and tell your friends and tell them to go back in time and watch the trailer and maybe leave a really mean comment. I mean, that's what you got to do, right? You
I mean, I'm
got to
here. You know what to
Oh yeah, I mean, did you see those the comments on the last teaser? Brazil,
do.
that was ooh, ooh, it was spicy, right? A lot of upvotes there as well. A lot of upvotes. Do you know what would make it
They're
even
all
better?
right.
We just call Biggs a snake, right? That's what we should do. Like that would be like the ultimate storm, and just have that debate. But we're not gonna do that. But what we are gonna do is something a little bit more positive today. Today is a wondrous, joyous day. Right, because we're about to, of course, announce the elitist raiding party officially at this point. Okay, we're going to do something fun today. We are going to discuss kind of our histories, our path through Guild Wars 2, the highs and the lows, everything, the history of the content creators, right? It's a very, a little bit narcissistic, a little bit egotistic, I suppose. But you know what? Hell, what are we doing on Twitch if not for that, right? So, well, let's get into this. I'm just going to open this with a question. Nike is probably, the most, erudite, historian of the game, certainly from the PvE scene. Can you tell us, where did it all begin for you? Where did Guild Wars 2 start for you?
So I mean, I started with Guild Wars 1, and then when Guild Wars 2 came out, I was playing in Head Start and beta and all that. And then on Head Start weekend, like, played basically out of the 72 hours of Head Start, I think I slept for like four
Oh,
and
man.
got to level cap like super fast. I think me and my friends were the first people to get to Cursed Shore because like we rushed there,
Yeah.
like because we expected there to be like an amazing meta event in Cursed Shore.
Ooh.
We're like, because like, dude, Straits of Devastation was so awesome, that meta event. We were like, dude, once you get enough people and you can have like all the lanes going, like Straits of Devastation is going to be the most awesome content in the game. And we were like, there's going to be something even better in the final map. And then you get there and there's nothing actually better in the final map. It's actually way worse. Straits of Devastation was actually the
Oh,
best
yeah.
open world PvE design in vanilla Guild Wars 2.
Yeah, the Balthazar, man. That Balthazar statue, dude. That's some crazy stuff. Like, oh.
And so basically me and my friends, since we all were PvPers in Guild Wars 1, our plan was to be PvPers and like small scale world people in Guild Wars 2. And then what ended up happening was we were like, well, we need exotic gear and we want to get it faster than everyone else. Because at that time, you could go into World v. World and one-shot the fuck out of people if you had exotic gear because everyone else was running around in like blues. It was great. Like, it actually felt like there was like a gear grind in Guild Wars 2 for like 2 weeks where if you worked your ass off and had a full exotics, you could go into World v. World and just like, Greatsword Warrior Blade Trail would just like one shot clowns. It was great. Like people in green gear would be chasing you, and you could throw your Blade Trail behind you at that point, which was like the funnest thing. And it would like one shot the people that were chasing you. Oh, it was so good. It felt so good to have better gear than everybody else. Like
Oh.
it was so good. And then and so anyway, to get said exotic gear, we had to do dungeons, and the easiest dungeon to do at the time was Koth Path 2. Like that was the first dungeon that people speed ran. And so we grinded that, and in the course of grinding that, like me and my friends, we met up with Strife, who was one of the probably the first like major like build and speed run guide creator. And we were running doing like dungeon runs, speed runs with him to get gear. And then eventually my friends all got banned for the
Oh.
snowflake thing in
Oh,
the
the.
first Christmas event,
Yeah. That's the
the
thing.
quote
That
unquote exploit that
did that
wasn't
get
an
Crip as well?
exploit.
That got Crip as well, right? Didn't it? Is that.
No, he got the chili thing,
Oh.
where you vendored the chilies, but yeah. So the Christmas, the snowflake non-exploit got all my friends banned, and that was like my entire dungeon group. So I joined Strife's Guild, which was Death and Taxes, which is where I met Brazil.
Hi.
Hello.
And here he is right now. So Brazil, wait, I mean, I'm sure this has been explained on your channel actually at some point, but what is the origin of Brazil? Because of course there is actually, and there's another video of you, isn't there actually? A League of Legends video, I think that,
That's an old video that has millions of views.
Yeah.
I would actually wait. There are two of them. Two League of Legends videos. One where it's just me and another guy, and it's like very obviously me because my voice is pretty distinguishable. The other one, like, it's my character in it, but you can't hear me talking. But they legit have like millions of views, but they're like pretty unknown at this point. But fuck. So yeah,
What's the Brazil story with Guild Wars 2 then?
The Brazil story with Guild Wars 2, like how I got my name, or just like how I started playing.
Just how you started playing, how you got into it, right? That sort of thing. And collided with Nike.
Yeah, so I guess how I got into the game is like I was a fat ass, lone, depressed, you know, little troll. And I thought, I don't have any friends. I'd like to meet some friends. Maybe I could play a video game and join a guild and make some friends. And so, like, that was, like, the first little baby step into me becoming, like, a functional human being. And so I started playing Guild Wars 2. I had some friends from high school. I was, like, maybe a freshman in college at the time. They were like, oh, yeah, Guild Wars 2 is cool. We bought it. You should buy it. You can play with us. And I thought, okay, neat. And so, like, I waited about a week, bought the game, like, right about launch, and they all quit playing because they ran out of stuff to do.
Nice.
And so, you know, we still have that problem, interestingly enough. But so, like, I just had the game by myself, and I was like, well, I just spent $50. I can either just, like, waste the $50 or, like, just play it on my own. And so I joined a guild after a little while and kind of made some friends. And then, like, I kind of wanted to get better at the game. And, like, I have this interesting problem where I have a huge ego, believe it or not. So, like, I thought I was really fucking good at the game already. And then I got I had some perspective given to me that maybe, in fact, that was not the case. And so I thought, well, then I can just get good. I can just fucking be good at the game. And so I found Strife's videos on YouTube and saw a guild recruitment video. And I said, I could probably do this. So I joined D&T, and we were doing a trial run in Ascalonian Catacombs. And there was another guy in the trial who was having some trouble with Gravelings and stability. And he and I both got into the guild, but he was not there as long as I was, which stands to reason, considering that Gravelings are pretty fucking easy to deal with. But then, like, I don't know. I met some other friends in the guild, like, grinded really fucking hard, pissed off a lot of people. Strife was making videos, and I thought I could probably make videos too. Like, I'd like to do that. So I started making videos, and for some reason, people thought they were – I won't say people liked them because I still don't think that's the case – but I think I intrigued people and was a controversial and interesting figure. And so people kind of stuck around. And so that was, I don't know, that's always been the fascination. But I met Nike in the guild. There were some people that came through, like DocMed, who tried to take over the guild and have his little Guild Wars 2 heist. And, like, I think we shut him down. There was some drama. But I don't know. Eventually, like, I got to the point where I was like, I play this game too much and I need to, like, kind of fuck off because I've made progress, but it's stopped. So I went away for a little while and I don't know, like, it was good to separate. And then I've come back a few times, but I'm, like, pretty not involved anymore other than Teapot stream on occasion. But yeah, Nike and I, like, we did a raw and shit and made videos and had a good time. It was fun.
Wow.
Fun game. Good game. But
dear.
ArenaNet has sabotaged it.
Yeah.
And they've ruined it.
I mean, guys, I'm I'm about to get, you guys are going to laugh at me because I'm going to sound like a proper casual now. I'm going to, oh dear, my story is a little bit different to those ones because, you know, I've always played Guild Wars 1 very casually, by the way, just, you know, a little bit of hard mode out there, you know, I didn't even really touch the PvP that much, you know, I just did all the hard mode stuff and some of the dungeons. It was, you know, this feels good, man. Not even God Walking Amongst Mere Mortals. And then Guild Wars 2. Guild Wars 2. And this was weird, actually, because for some reason I was very excited about it, right? I think I saw all the marketing, you know, all the cool cutscenes and stuff, like not the taxi one, obviously. And, you know, maybe not the graffiti one either. But aside from that, I was like, dude, this looks awesome. This looks amazing. And I played the beta weekend. And my PC at the time was a complete potato, right? It was like barely capable of running it. And I thought, holy shit. You know, I remember this, guys. Like, the first thing I noticed, I was like, oh my god. The character's feet adjust to the levels of the terrain. I was like, oh my god, this is amazing. Like, this game is absolutely insane. And I saw the way the combat system was and how you could fight all the monsters and how it was more open world, okay, than Guild Wars 1. Although, actually, I was really disappointed. I have to confess it. I was expecting them to go the World of Warcraft route because I was playing WoW at the time, actually. I was playing the World of Warcraft. I was really hoping for that full open world experience from that type of game, but that didn't happen. But yeah, I was used to it because of Guild Wars 1, and you know, and Guild Wars 1 does it in a really good way as well. So you know, it wasn't too bad. And then the launch came round, and you know what? It's funny. I have a slightly similar story to Brazil here. Actually, I started playing the game a lot. Right. I basically what I would do is I would come home every day, and I would just play the fucking game, right, until I was incapable of playing. And my goal at the time, okay, look, I should have posted to Reddit. I should have done this. My goal was the Bifrost, because I was on my elementals. So I was like, dude, I want the fucking Bifrost, right? That's what I want. I see that stuff, and oh my god.
Staff, it was even yeah. good. And
it was so good. It was, I just wanted that skin, man, okay? I was going to go for it, and I basically burned myself out in the game and quit, actually, because, oh, it hurt to grind all of that out. But I got there in the end, and I crafted the Bifrost, and then bam. I was also doing a bit of YouTube at this time as well, so like, you know, this is my origin story, I suppose. But Guild Wars 2 was not even particularly a focus. I was actually making some different types of videos, like some videos that no one will ever find on stuff like StarCraft 2 and even League of Legends, actually. Just a little bit of this, a little bit of that. I did some Guild Wars 2 stuff. I thought they were fun. Some fun videos, but I was more varied until, okay, the man, the myth, the legend, okay, posted one of my videos to the subreddit, and that is how I decided, oh, whoa, it's Guild Wars 2 stuff. Like, these people are really nice, you know? Like, they were suddenly, I went from like 100 subs on my channel on YouTube to like 1K in one day or something. I was like, whoa, these guys are pretty nice. And then I made some more videos, and they liked them as well. But at the time, you know, it's funny, actually, I didn't have much time to play games at this point, because I was busy with school and I was training a lot as well. So it actually took all the way until mid Heart of Thorns, or when the raids started coming out, before I actually started playing in the fashion that you see now. Like, but in the early days, guys, I'm going to expose myself, and this is why I have a lot of sympathy to the casual players, actually. Like, my gameplay in Guild Wars 2 for a very long time consisted of doing map completion. I would do like a map every day, okay, because I still to this day like map completion, by the way, my friends, okay. I'd do the map completion, then I would AFK world bosses and just like leech the rewards, just over, you know, round. That was some good times, man. And you know what Nike said there about the the Straits of Devastation was, as it was, it really resonates, actually, because like when I first came across this event, I was like, holy shit, dude, like we were all getting farmed insanely hard, right, just brutally hard by the, you know, by the Risen Priest of Balthazar. You know, that was challenging content, guys, at the time. That was challenging content. This was when magic find gear was around as well, so everyone was going around in fucking magic find gear.
For sure, events where you just camped at Shelter Gate and
let the event fail over and over
to farm the magic mobs. Find gear, and like you're just getting like tons and tons of loot.
Yeah,
like,
it was insane. Oh, I don't know if anyone remembers this. Does anyone remember this farm? I wonder if anyone in the chat remembers this. Do you guys remember the Plinks farm, right?
Oh yeah, I think I do.
Yes. Yeah.
The Plinks farm, because this was something that I would do in the background, right? Oh, they did. Yeah, man, like this is something that I was really big into, actually. Farming heavy moldy bags, right? Oh man, holy shit, those are the good times, man. Really nice AFK chill farming content, going around in circles, big magic find, big memes, and an insane amount of mobs. Fun fact, I had a really unconventional method of making my second legendary. Incinerator was my second legendary, right? And I needed a lot of gold for it. I decided. Oh,
yeah. The dagger. Is that the one that I helped you with?
No, that was Bolt. Okay, let's
see. Oh, right. Yeah, that was unconventional.
Yeah, that really was unconventional. But anyway, so to make this all the gold, I thought, you know, I'm really lazy and I can't be bothered to flip items. So I know what I'll do. I will make a program that calculates the value of bags, heavy loot bags and heavy moldy bags, and I'll buy them lower than their actual opening value. Then I'll open the bags and sell the results, right? And this was, it was actually incredibly effective. I made the gold in about a week. I made about 2K gold in a week, which at the time was actually insane. Because I would literally, this was horrific. I did this for hours, dude. I legitimately did this for hours a day. But yeah, I made a lot of gold. And then I really burned out. Like after the incinerator, I was like, oh my God. Like logging into the game was like physically painful at that point. Because I was a filthy casual, dude. I had my incinerator. I'd just wave it around on my dagger Ellie. That's another thing. I used to play World versus World roaming on Selly Ellie, man. Oh
yeah, unkillable. Oh. Like, that build of that time, you could like 5v1 and just sustain indefinitely. That was a very good build.
Yeah, but you know, it was not until much later where I actually started, properly playing the game. But you know, so I mean, with you two, then it's, you know, you certainly progressed to the next level. Well, I suppose Nike even faster, actually, because of his history with Guild Wars 1. But you know, like I think me and Brazil were at casual early on, then kind of started going hard. But Nike was going hard all the way from the beginning.
No, Brazil was actually in DNT a month before me.
Oh, okay,
yeah.
Because I didn't need to join D&T because, like, my dungeon group, like, was, like, we had, Strife was in our group. And we had people that, like Z was another guy who later joined D&T. But, like, we had our own, like, core of, like, five people. So, like, I didn't feel, like, the need to join a guild until they all got banned. And then I was like, well, I need good people to play with because I can't play with pugs. So... then I joined D&T, but Brazil had already been there for like a month or two.
Okay. Do you have particularly fond memories of the old school dungeon days, right? Like, because of course the gameplay is hugely different. Like, would you even say you have a preference, or is it more of an evolution thing, right? Like, whereabouts would you say the game kind of peaked for you in terms of the gameplay and the enjoyment of the gameplay? Like, was it in the dungeon days, or do you appreciate both? Like, what's the story there?
I think there was like two peaks. Like the peak of peaks, I think, was Wing 1.
Okay.
Right when Wing 1, like maybe like a week after Wing 1, when people were like starting to like refine strategies and figure out builds, I think like that was like when the community was most excited about like the PvE endgame. And then I think that there was like definitely a peak in the dungeon days where like there was just so much activity and competition where you had like multiple guilds like doing stuff and like people pushing solo times. There was a lot of that, but like that was all a pretty long era, but yeah, I think that was like super fun at those times specifically. Yeah.
When this had a bit of a resurgence recently. I think I recall not too long ago, there were a few, a few people kind of trying to one up each other, like records being posted within an hour of each other on Reddit, right? But of course, it was even more intense back then. Like, I you have to correct me if I'm wrong, but I believe there was like some path where people were literally, it was 15 minutes. Like, people were beating these records like 15 minutes back and forth, like memeing each
other. The Euros, like the RT and the precursor to Snowcrows, Define. Those two guilds were in like very heavy competition with each other for a while, and I think it was like SE Path 1. Like that record exchanged hands like 4 times over the course of 3 days or something like that. Like, and then like Dub would also do, Dub who was in RT would do like, he would have loopy solos on every class just saved. And if anyone uploaded a faster time, he would just upload one of the ones he had saved that was like 2 seconds faster than whatever they did. And then if someone like went back and beat us 2 seconds faster, he would just upload another one of the ones that he had saved that was 2 seconds faster than that. And he would just keep beating people's solo times by like 2 seconds. It was
that is an extreme big brain play right there. And it's good to see that this has somewhat survived, right? We still see some Lupica solos. I think Raul recently did a really fast loopy solo, I believe, on Condi Weaver, I think. So, you know, it's still going. And you know what? I think the community still has a lot of respect for that type of play. It does well on the subreddit, right? Like, you know, people have seem to be still impressed. So I think, you know, I think it's a mark of a well-aged game mode, right? Like you do have to kind of think, what if with dungeons, right? Like to a certain extent, right? You know, what if, because of course there was no real development towards dungeons. We had Aetherpath, obviously, but aside from like a few minor tweaks and some bug fixes, you know, dungeons they're not really that different from launch, right? Like in terms of like how they actually are, like there was no real development to them, I think, right?
Yeah, they revamped Asconian Catacombs, like a small revamp, and that was like the last they really did of touching the old content.
Yeah,
well, they tried to redo them, like they revamped AC. That was wildly unpopular because people didn't know how to use stun breaks and stability, and they didn't realize that they could change out their like utility skills or traits in the middle of a run. They thought that like you just like go to Lion's Arch, pick a build, and never change it. Like that was people's idea of like
well, that hasn't changed.
Yeah. And so like that was wildly unpopular, even though it like was significantly easy to fucking do the dungeon. But like they redid the COF Path 2 end event, so like people wouldn't be so inclined to just like death rush it, since they changed the waypointing while in combat. And then I think they did Aether Path after that, because people wouldn't shut the fuck up on the official forums about forward up being just like gravely impossible. And after Aether Path, that was it. Like it was just universally hated.
Hang on just 1 second though, because I know there was one other dungeon, wasn't there, that was a bit close to your heart, I think, right, Brazil? The what was it called? The, you know, the one that's now Molten Furnace and Molten Boss, right?
Yeah, Molten Facility.
Molten Facility, yeah. Was that technically a dungeon? Or what was it?
It was, but they added it and they removed it. Yeah. It was very, very... Like, it was honestly good. Like, it was really good. And, like, there were things about it that were just so well done. Like, dungeons are almost entirely, like, either normal mobs that die in, like, 2 crits from a greatsword auto attack, or they're elites that are just, like, a fucking clusterfuck spam that will just, like, wreck you if you don't, like, use mechanics to defeat them, or, like, pull them into a corner and blind them. And, like, they're just rough to deal with. Not so much now. Like, Molten Facility had, like, actual events in it and, like, checkpoints, and, like, the terrain was interesting. Like, the environment was interesting. Like, there was stuff happening, and you're like, what the fuck? This is cool shit. And, like, there were varied mobs. Like, there were, like, elites within, like, packs of veterans and normal mobs. So you were like, oh, that's the big guy. We gotta go fuck him up. And, like, you deal with it was just very well done, honestly, and, like, they took it out of the game.
Yeah, the day that they, like, hit the delete button and were like, well, we won't need that content anymore, yeah. Like, management should have burned a timeout and been like, wait a second, how many man hours went into making this content? Oh, I don't know, a couple thousand, and we're just going to hit delete and not even save it so that it could be added again later. Like, basically save it, like they saved the assets so that they could like hodgepodge a fractal out of them, but not really. Like that mindset is like incredible. I cannot believe that no one in management said that this is a bad idea. The leading content that we put thousands of man hours into, like, insane. No other business would ever even consider doing that. That was probably the dumbest move of all the dumb moves that Anet's ever done, was deleting those.
Shall we talk a little bit about season one then? Just in general, the living story, the original vision for Guild Wars 2, because, you know, you've got to give them credit where it's due, guys. Season one and season two as well, the world was changing, right? A lot of things were happening and changing. And you know what? I will say this. From my perspective at the time, I actually thought it was fucking incredible, right?
It made it an event. You know how like everyone's like, oh, well, in this era of streaming services, there's no like appointment television where everyone in the country is like sitting around their TV at the same time sharing the same experience. Like season one of Living Story, like it was a shared experience. Like you had to be logged in live and experiencing it with everyone else when it was going down, or else you didn't experience it. So there is something to be said about that shared experience. That's exciting.
Mm. And the cadence was quite remarkable as well. Like releases every 2 weeks, right? And it's true that not every release had an insane amount to do in it, right? You know, the whole repairing signs of Flame and Frost meme, you know? Yeah, it's maybe not that exciting.
It's more content than we're getting now, at least. Running down a road and pressing F to repair signposts, like I would take.
I mean, you can run around and press F to collect skyscale eggs. Like it's nothing's changed. The more things change, the more they stay the same.
It's exactly the same. Yeah.
I think the biggest like misjudgment that they made is like they were actually convinced that no one knew would come play the game outside of like the first Living Story. They thought they were just going to drive in like millions of players, and like in 2017 there wouldn't be any new players, and like everyone that was still playing when like season one and the game launched were out would all still be around, so they could be like, yeah, I remember this. This is why Kessex Hills is all fucked up. But instead, like, all of those people just quit. And now there are new people that come in and they don't have a fucking clue. And also, like, they don't know why Kessex Hills is just a fucking shit show of a map. But there aren't really that many OG people around to explain it to them. So they go and read, like, some role player's fan fiction on the wiki or something about, like, it is just, like, it was, the execution was not very good. They should have, like, saved all of that. But
yeah, they certainly regret it now. They do try and kind of give you a recap, right, with the NPC in Lion's Arch of season one and two, but it's not quite the same, right? It's not quite the same. Yeah, it really sucks. And actually, the departure from that type of content was what when maps started to become frozen in time is when the world did start feeling a lot more static, because it literally became a lot more static. ArenaNet really changed their approach there. You know what episode really stood out for me though, guys, right? And I'm sure this is the same for many people, right? It is, of course, Lost Shores.
Oh, the Kraken.
The Karka.
The Kraken.
Man. Like, this was insane. I honestly wish they'd kept... I wish they would still do stuff like this, actually. I'm really sad that they don't.
You didn't crash once, like, during that event?
No, okay.
And not be able to get back into the instance? Like, that was terrible.
I know a lot of people...
Like, one frame every year? Like, it was terrible. It was so bad.
I know a lot of people had problems, but I actually had a remarkably good experience, actually. Like, yeah, my FPS was terrible. Everything was desynced. I was getting killed. The Karka were not rendering for me. There were like 15, there was like four times a 15 minute event or something, right? Of just Karkas just attacking you. Until you eventually fight the big one and you're running away from the Karka. And, oh man, it was epic. Yes, the performance was not good. Yes, it was maybe not the best experience server wise, but I got away with it. I didn't crash. And I got my fucking precursor, boys. I got Howl, right? And you know what? That was a monumental event. Like, I you know what? even if it was in a different context, I really wish ArenaNet would do stuff like that. But I guess they won't, because that was, there was literally a one-time event, right? Like, if you miss that, it is fucking gone, right? Like, that queen dies and she is dead forever, right? Like, that is just such a cool thing to have in your MMO, right? It does make it feel alive. It makes it feel exciting. But, I mean, hey, I guess that's dead and buried at this point. But yeah, like, Lost Shores was fucking epic. But it wasn't just the one-off stuff, right? Because there was some one-off stuff, but... to be honest, like, all of it was pretty nice, right? Like, I mean, the battle with Scarlet with the holograms, right? That was fucking awesome. Battle on the Breachmaker. Yeah, the one, it was actually a bit like VG, wasn't it? With the color.
It literally was.
Tuned to colors. Yeah. And then, yeah. You do the right thing of damage.
Yeah. And again, the marionette fight. I'm sure everyone remembers the marionette fight. And even Silver Waste, when it originally
came out. I have a negative take. I'm probably the only person that hates the marionette fight.
Okay. Yeah.
Because more than one time, all the other lane, like, so like all five or whatever lanes had to finish the marionette fight.
Yep.
And one lane failed, the whole thing failed. So you'd have four lanes that killed theirs and were just sitting around waiting while the timer was ticking down. And there'd be like another one of those little circles that everyone stood in. And there would be a fucking Barebow Ranger attacking the boss that you could only hit from the back. You could only do damage from the back. And this guy would just be sitting there shooting at its face, doing no damage, not taking any damage either, because he's playing probably like full soldiers. And everyone in map chat's like, you have to hit him from the back, idiot. Hit him from the back. Just hit him. And he would just sit there with his longbow at close range, auto-attacking, doing zero damage. And then, of course, the event fails, and everyone feels like they wasted their entire lives and they want their money back. And that happened so many times that I do not have fond memories of that event whatsoever. The wins and the successes were great, but the times where you lost because of one goddamn idiot screwing it up for the entire map, like, it's not like Triple Trouble where like you need like 10 idiots to screw it up for the whole map. Like, literally one idiot could screw it up for the whole map. And that was enough. I could not handle that. It was terrible.
I actually, like, I wasn't around for the Lost Shores backing up to that because I didn't want to, like, get... But, like, I also have thoughts on the marionette, too. Like, Lost Shores, I was visiting a friend in Kansas for a choir performance because he really wanted me to go see him. And I was like, whatever. So I went. And, like, I missed all of, like, that for the most part, but got back just in time to, like, get into a couple of instances, like, right as the queen was dying and not get anything out of it. But, like, I think my best memory from that, even though it's not much, was there was a guy in our guild named Kind Buds that fucking got into, like, 65 overflow maps and killed the Kraken Queen like 40 times and got a shit ton of fucking precursors. He had a precursor, like just about a precursor for every single weapon type that was usable, like on all of his characters. Like the underwater shit, like he just wanted to be decked out in precursors because I guess it was unfeasible to do that in legendaries at the time. Like, that was good. But the fucking, like, the marionette, I remember that. Because, like, I just like the colors, like the green and the gold. And, like, I don't know, I thought it was fine. I could AFK and just not put any effort into it and just watch people get mad. Which is kind of what I did. We're on the opposite end of that. Like, people fucking it up for everyone made you mad. But, like, that's what I was there for.
Oh,
I just wanted to see map chat explode.
Well, and like, you know, it's gone the other way around now. Because now Nike, you know, he likes one burning the Octovine. It's that's a good show.
Educational.
It's toxic.
That's trying to help them.
What happened to Burn though? Like, Burn disbanded.
Yeah, Burn disbanded because I was in a Burn group and I was talking in squad chat and I go, okay, everyone kill the frogs first so that we can get a clean burn. And the low information voters in the squad, none of them went to the frogs. And they all went and, like, immediately started, like, pushing the thing and started burning. And the frog's belly flopped on us and wiped us. And we failed the one burn. And I was like, look, even this guild is too stupid to survive. Like, this guild has one mission. Like, literally, this guild exists for one mission, and we're too stupid for that. So we just got to pull the plug. Like,
wow,
just never going to get better. So got to go.
Wait, did you lead that guild or something?
Yeah. I disbanded it after that. Oh, I was like, look, if the frogs belly flop too hard for us to handle, we got to go. Got to go.
Oh yeah, those frogs are really dangerous, man. Because they with the is it the tongue?
Yeah,
attack?
They're so
they
dangerous, which is why,
right?
Before the event started, everyone kill the frogs first. And the non-English speakers, I can only presume everyone was a non-English speaker. Literally, everyone in the squad was a non-English speaker, so that's why they didn't listen to me.
They had no idea what the hell was going on. Yeah.
What about the triple trouble worm?
Oh,
that?
Dude.
Oh, that was fucking. That was a. Nike and I, we were on in a with it was attuned, right?
That was Blackgate / attuned / wooden potatoes. I guess wooden potatoes is an attuned then.
He was, yeah. There were
of characters in that Discord, or not, it wasn't even a Discord, it was like a Ventrilo server,
TeamSpeak.
Yeah, there was so many like weirdos like that had no business being there. Oh, and Chris Cleary was there for most of the polls.
Wow.
Trolling.
Wait, what?
Trolling the event.
He was trolling.
He was hard exposed.
Wait, what was he doing?
Trolling our triple trouble kills.
So the Chris Cleary, like, there were things about the event that were obviously not tested because they've never tested literally any content they've ever released. Like, not a single time have they ever fucking tested anything. But, like, Chris Cleary he knew that if the worm went out of a certain, like, boundary that was, like, defined, that it would downscale and just immediately die because, like, it wouldn't scale to the amount of people that there were. So, like, it happened accidentally a couple of times where it got close and he would just despawn it. Like, he would just, like, I guess, like, right-click the fucking model and just click despawn or whatever and, like, reset it. He was like, don't take it over there. Like, don't do that. And I guess nobody figured it out at first, but then people started to, like, realize what was going on. I think one of the heads did it accidentally and just immediately blew up, but nobody killed the other two. But, like, he was also, like, streaming during some of it. And he was streaming, like, with an auto-click, like, auto-join map script running while he was just AFK. And, like, at the same time, fucking, like, telling people in map chat, like, you're not allowed to, like, bot to get into the maps. Like, you're not allowed to auto-click. You're not allowed to, like, fucking, like, have tools that join the map for you. And he's literally fucking doing it on stream himself.
And we were like on the TeamSpeak trying to convince everyone to run DPS builds because it was actually like a hard DPS check.
Oh, at the time. Oh yeah. Oh yeah.
And we were begging people to run DPS builds. Chris Cleary on his stream, he's showing his gear. He's running a full healer's NG back in 2013 or whatever when that build did nothing. I don't even know like what it did. I don't know how it healed. But he was just running like a full cleric's NG. And we're like, can you please run berserker gear? And he's like, lol. And it was like, oh God, this guy is like head of security. Oh my God.
Oh no.
Yeah, I mean, personally, it takes me about 2 weeks to learn how to play a new class.
Yeah,
there were some
I think her name was Meow Mix.
Yes!
And
holy shit.
She was playing Condi Necro.
Oh.
Which what? But this was before. This was
the
Condi revamp.
Oh no.
Yes. So Condi was a hard zero DPS.
Yeah.
And we were like, can you just run like even soldiers? Because at that point you couldn't crit the worm. So just having power main stat was all that mattered. We're like, can you just run soldiers? And she goes, when do we want to kill this? We're like, tonight. And she goes, it takes me 2 weeks to learn a new build within my playstyle. And I was like, oh God. Oh man.
And then there
was like an angry Scottish guy.
Yeah, I know how to play any class.
Yeah. That guy. Hard, He did not like Card at all. Like, no. Card said something that triggered him, and he was like, I know how to play me class! Like super aggro. This guy was getting pissed. Because I think he was like running some like main stat precision or something like that. Like, look, it doesn't do anything. You need to run main stat power. Yeah. Well, yeah, it was like something like that.
Wow. And like, he was out of hand. The strategy was Crimson Float Team, where you had like a select few people that like were capable of like putting Berserker's armor on. Like that was the qualification for it. Like that was what was considered high DPS. And so the strategy was for like everybody just to split off and like go role play with their friends on the Wormheads. And like you would kill the one in the middle, and then Crimson Float Team would like waypoint over and like run to the other one and try to burn it and kill it. And like immediately upon hearing that for the very fucking first time, like everyone from D&T was like, no, why don't we just split up the DPS and just fucking like move them as needed.
Yeah, and kill all three worms simultaneously. Yeah. What a surprise. Yeah. What a novel idea to do that, to kill all three simultaneously.
But yeah, it was, we ended up like, we didn't get the world's first. There was a European group that did, and that was annoying because it easily could have fucking happened if people just, I don't know, if they just stopped sitting on top of their heads. But
this, well, I think, you know, power creep aside, because I think a big part of why the worm was so challenging was, again, as you say, you know, conditions hadn't been reworked yet. You know, not everyone had like permanent every boon in the game, right? That just wasn't really a thing. And people were worse at the game, obviously, which didn't help. But, you know, it's, you know, why do you think ArenaNet moved away from that kind of challenging content? Like, it was more challenging then than it is now, of course. But
correct at all. I think the problem was that people were just unwilling to cooperate because they were all just like, I don't necessarily know that delusional is the correct word, because I don't know like how intense it was in everybody's mind, but they were just like, they just wouldn't yield and wouldn't compromise. Like they just refused. So like, no, it's good enough. Other people will pick up the slack for me. But you had like 80% of the people there thinking like that. And people just wouldn't like experiment with changing builds or traits and like putting on like more offensive stats, and like just not like that. That was a problem. Like, I really think that was a problem. And I don't think that that's ever changed in the history of Guild Wars 2. Like, I think that's still exactly the same problem that's happening with all of the content in the game. I think ArenaNet realized that. And so that's ultimately like why they've backed away from the hard content. I think like people that like really play the game hardcore, I don't think they spend as much like hard-earned dollars on the game as the people that just like refuse to do anything differently, maybe. And so like I think that's ultimately like, I really think that's the issue. You have anomalies like me that just fucking like, I just can't be bothered to grind, and I don't want to do that, so like I spend $30,000 on Guild Wars 2 and like get Christmas cards every year from ArenaNet. But
I don't think that they will. I think they moved away from doing open world stuff because of how annoying it was to get in the map. Because it was also before overflow servers. So like you'd be in Bloodtide Coast trying to get into whatever the other, or maybe the map was, maybe it's in Bloodtide Coast, I forget, but you'd be in one of the maps trying to get in, and like it would literally say like world is full. And like you, even if you wanted to map complete that map and didn't want to have anything to do with it, there was no like overflow for you. It was just like that instance is full. So you literally just couldn't play the game. Like people that wanted to do world completion were locked out on the Blackgate server, were locked out of that map for like till they killed it. Like, and even then, like the daily respawns or whatever, like it was, you were still locked out. Like, so I think they just really wanted to separate challenging content from the open world. I think that became like, don't let it impact anyone's experience negatively if they don't want it.
It's
to impact them.
It's sad though, don't you think? Right? That was a massive event. It was a huge event. You know, like
it was insane.
Yeah,
it was really good.
The hype levels, right?
I mean, yeah, that was everything that like the Guild Wars 2, the promise of dynamic events and the promise of like the open world system and like the whole like organization, like organizing, like that was what Guild Wars 2 open world was supposed to be. But I don't think it was what a lot of people wanted. And that was like the first sign that Innit would cave in to the people that didn't want other people to have a certain type of fun.
Yes, it was a masterpiece. Ooh. And I don't know.
Yeah.
See, it's like the Mona Lisa, I think, is an interesting painting. I don't know that I would call it good or bad, but there are some people, it's just, they realize other people enjoy looking at this painting. And I don't like it. So I hate that they enjoy it.
Ooh.
My fantasy is to steal it and rip it into pieces and wipe my ass with it. that's the mindset we're talking about here. See, like that's the thing.
There is a certain level of toxicity, right? From that kind of crowd, right? It does get a little bit crazy. In that sort of thing, but you know, it did make a bit of a resurgence, right? Like, you know, you can listen all about this in Nike's video, right? But they tried to bring it back with Heart of Thorns, right? The open world, it was a bit dangerous, right? You know, there were dangerous NPCs. You had Chat Geraint, right? Chat Geraint, people going crazy. That was I would say Chat Geraint on launch was, it probably wasn't as extreme as Triple Trouble, but there was a lot of hype on getting, you know, world's first or one of the first kills for the Chat Geraint. You know, it was a big deal.
Yeah, and they had, by that point they had solved the whole getting into the map situation to where like if you had a guild of 50 players who were like decent players, you could get them all into the right map given enough like lead time, like a half hour, get there a half hour early and you could form up. So they had solved the main problem. Plus there were overflows, so if you were just trying to hit all your points of interest and map and didn't care about the meta event, like you could just get into an overflow and keep mapping. So they had solved the problem, which you would think would mean that they should just leave the content hard. But I think people also felt like they were, that Chat Geraint was so hard that they were being, and they needed it to finish their legendaries, that they were like gated out of finishing their legendaries through hard content. Like, I think that was like the main, like, reason why people wanted it nerfed, was that they're like, well, I need to kill the Chat Geraint to get my legendaries, because it's like the only way to get the currency or whatever, so it needs to be easy enough.
I think that's like an interesting thing too, like legendaries were meant to be something that you had to fucking like put in some goddamn effort
and play a lot, like, of content, right?
You had to play the game. You had to be like a badass to get a legendary.
Well, you had to play World New World too. Like that was the intention. Yeah. You had to
do map completion. World versus World map completion. Yes, by the way, guys,
100%.
Which was so fun. Oh my god! Since we're reminiscing about good old times, so the best way to get your things done in World v. World, to get your badges of honor that you needed to buy your gift of battle, was to do the jumping puzzle.
The jumping puzzles, dude! I used to do the every day!
Jumping puzzle trophy.
Yeah, so one day we went in there with like 10 D&T people, and we just camped the entrance of the Obsidian Sanctum jumping puzzle, and everyone who came down, we instantly killed. Like, for like... like probably at least 12 hours in a row, just killed every single person. And it happened, we did it for like days because it never stopped being funny. And eventually someone went to the forums and went, there's a troll guild called D&T that's camping the jumping puzzle and preventing people from getting their legendaries. We have to do something about stopping these griefers. It was so good.
Dantane like came in like, oh my god,
he got pulled down.
Temporal curtain off the fucking edge of the platform. It was literally just like full like cheese that should never have like been, like it never should have worked. Like we'd fucking like stealth, like time warp on the group of people when they're waiting for the portal up, and like warriors with berserker's armor would come out with like frenzy, hunter blade, and endure pain, and just fucking like chop down 30, 40 people. Just it was wonderful. It was beautiful. It was like coordinated. It was just like that's fucking like what World vs. World is all about. Yeah, I've only had a PvP zone.
You should be able to grief people. Like, that's what the whole point of it is. Like that's that was like for me the best times in World v World was just like knowing that you were preventing someone from achieving their goals by killing them in PvP. Like, you couldn't even call it griefing because the game, like, the whole idea is you're supposed to kill people.
That's the point, right?
Getting to the top of the jumping
puzzle. You can do whatever you want. Like, it's a sandbox. Yeah.
Like,
oh, man.
If they wanted to just be a jumping puzzle where you got a reward at the end, they could have just disabled PvP there. And so they wanted you to be able to kill people.
Yeah.
I've had one other comparable experience to that, and it still wasn't as good, but it was amazing. And that was playing with a group of people that have two-story houses with a nice staircase. And we fucking, like, pushed an entire server right to their fucking spawn, like, over the course of, like, an hour. And then just unloaded fucking siege in front of their spawn and just spawn camped them for, like, a solid 4 hours straight. Like, fucking, like, it was wonderful because you have an entire fucking server of people that can't play the game. Like, they want to come in and do, and they can't. Like, they can't. It's just, and then you get bored and then you stop and then they can play, but it's just, it's hilarious. Like, just,
oh, yeah.
That's what PvP and World versus World are about. Yeah. Like, yeah, you go through your objectives, but then you just fuck with people and you just troll them.
It's honestly one of the reasons why Guild Wars 2 World versus World is just, it is the underutilized game mode, right? Like, it is such a good mode, right? The politics of it, the player-driven content is always going to be fun, right? That's what's going to give you that longevity. That's going to give you the content, right? World versus World was good. You know, a little bit more on World versus World, the obvious thing to talk about is what the hell happened with World versus World? I mean, I think the obvious place to go is to talk about seasons, right? Like, of course, the big thing that kind of happened for World versus World, aside from stuff like fixing culling, and that sort of thing, was seasons. We're going to have World versus World season. I actually don't know. When was that in the history? Like, where is World versus World season?
2013.
It was quite early, wasn't it? It was fairly early on, right, that they decided to do this. And it lasted for 2 seasons. Nice.
Yeah, the first season was awesome. I loved it. Like, because the achievements were not easy. Like, they weren't like you could just play for one day and get them all done. Like, you had to dedicate, like, a month of solid playtime. And, like, during that month, people were like, oh, we don't want PvEers in the game mode. But, like, for that month, like, when we weren't in dungeons, we were in World v World, like, playing World v World how it was intended to be played. Like, actually trying. Like, so it was great. But then the second season, they made it, like, piss easy so you could get all the achievements done in 2 days.
Yeah.
And the whole argument was, well, then the PvEers will come in, they'll get their achievements, and then they'll leave. And then it'll be back to what we wanted. But then guess what? It went back to what it was, which is why they needed seasons in the first place. It was because it was becoming less active.
And also provide, assuming that the game would still receive development, you know, that's how you get new players. Like, you're going to have some people coming in from PvE because that's where most people are, right? There were, of course, at the time, a lot of people came into Guild Wars 2 for the Guild Wars, right? For the World versus World. And you had a lot of big content creators like Angry Joe shouting out, like, dude, World versus World is amazing. Like, come and play this. You know, a lot of people, you know, coming over from stuff like DAOC, right? Like, they go, yeah, let's fucking go, dude. Like, let's play World versus World. So it was one of the main attractions of the game, right? Was World versus World. And the seasons exemplified that. But, you know, the lack of, I think it really suffered from rewards as well. Like, if you didn't do well, you got, like, spikes, right, or some shit. Like, it was actually insane. Like, you got completely nothing. And of course, yeah, the second season was just like, oh dear.
Yeah, I wish I still had my, because we were on Blackgate, so we won the first season, and you got a special finisher.
Yeah.
I haven't used mine. And they were temporary, though. I wish I hadn't used mine. It would be nice to have those World finishers.
Look at this stream. Okay, take a look at this. There we go. I only ever used one. I don't know why they didn't make it infinite, by the way. Like, that is a little, I guess it could have not been infinite under the assumption that they were ever going to do it again, right? But there we go. Yeah, I've got my golden dolly. Yeah,
if you were picking up one of those every season, it would be okay. Season, like, yeah. It'd be fine.
But... Yeah, 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 save it for a special occasion, right?
You know, maybe they could bring that back as like an actual World v. World reward for people to grind to when you get like Ultimate Dominator, I mean, you get that finisher. Like, I mean, what kind of crazy idea is that?
Yeah, I mean, it's literally in the game, right? So it couldn't be that bad, right, to bring it back. But, you know, there you go. Oh, man. Dude, I remember those days. I didn't really properly play World vs. World, but, I did play. I had hours in the game, right? And I would go around and like, get in the Zergs, right? Cast my meteor shower on people. That was
the best world experience I had was in beta, because nobody had a commander tag because they were 100 gold and no one in beta had 100 gold, so you had to play World v. World without a tag. So there was no Zerg, there was just guild groups running around, and it was like the biggest group might have been like 20 people. And there were no, it was just a completely different experience. That was super fun to me.
I actually think that this might be a hot take here. I think World vs. World is actually better that way. Like keeping it relatively small scale and without the stacking. I think the stacking is kind of, it's a bit toxic for World vs. World. Like I think maybe keeping the target cap actually uncapped might have actually been better. For the game mode, in terms of like actually being good, right? Or maybe having some kind of collision, right? So you can't run through people and stack on top of each other like that. But it would have promoted, I think, a lot more dynamic and almost like immersive gameplay, right? Because in real life, if you're doing a battle, two sides are battling each other, they're not all standing on top of each other in a big blob, are they, right? That doesn't happen in real life. Okay, but, you know, it's more of a spread out thing, right? You've got people charging at each other, going crazy, and yep, the servers may not have been able to handle it, right? The skill lag would have been unbearable, I'm sure, even more so than it already was. But it's interesting to see the way that the game ended up developing, right? Social awkwardness.
Yeah, like without Zergs, the like if everyone was small scale, the incentives would be for you and your friends to like pick an area of the map and kind of like make it like your turf and like kill anything that came in there and capture anything. Make sure you held all the objectives and also kill anybody, other groups that like wandered into your turf. Like that would be, and I think to me that would be the most fun.
Yeah.
Because you're just like this kill squad. You're like, okay, we're going to take this outpost and everything around it. We're going to kill anyone who comes. Plus you got loot for escorting Doliaks.
Yeah, oh wow.
The old supply system. That kind of fucked up the game in a couple different ways, but I think there was a lot to be said about the whole idea of like the whole thing being like a war of attrition, like rewarding people for like fighting the war of attrition is like really good.
Ithamir says, remember the orbs.
Oh
yeah, we had to rush
the crate as
reset.
Well.
Yeah,
I had an interesting real life experience with that. I was in community college at the time, and there was a guy in my U.S. history class who was talking about Guild Wars 2, and so we started talking about Maguma fly hacking over the walls to steal the orbs, and about like that was an interesting experience. But I really do remember that. That was fucking cool. That was the first time I think Guild Wars 2 leaked into real life. There were a few of those.
Whoa.
And I regret all of them.
Oh.
All but one, actually. My girlfriend is the ultimate Guild Wars 2 leaking into real life.
Oh. Oh, man.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's
That was in-game. That was fucking in-game.
For World vs. World, though, I know we're, you know, in the story of Guild Wars 2, we haven't really gone that far yet. We've barely touched Heart of Thorns, or we've just gone back to the season, right? But that's actually kind of where it ends for World vs. World, isn't it? That's quite funny, now that I think about it. In fact, that's extremely funny. It's not if you play World vs. World.
Yeah,
but,
they froze the other maps in time, yeah. And then they froze World vs. World in time, so the story didn't progress.
Yeah, of course, we did have the reward rework, and, you know, they changed it with skirmishing and linking, but that's not... It's not quite the same as something like Seasons or, well, you know, hey, better late than never. Alliance is coming soon, TM, right? oh, dear. So, let's, I don't want to say the next topic, right? Because we saw people in chat talking about social awkwardness. And what does that remind us of? Okay, fractals. Because Fractals weren't always a thing. And even better, they were very, very different when the game actually started, actually. Nike, you were a big fan of that, right? The old progression system.
Yeah, Brazil too.
Yep.
Brazil was one of the first people to hit 80, and he did it on stream.
Yes.
That was a grind.
That was probably the closest I've ever actually been to suicide.
What?
It was horrible. I remember saying, we were progressing. This was Fractal 80. This was like to get 80. And we had just gotten through Dredge, which took about an hour.
To an hour, yeah.
Yes. We had gotten through Cliffside as well. I think it was Cliffside and Dredge. And I said, if we get fucking snowblind, I'm going to cut my dick off on stream. And I'm going to stop playing this game. And guess what fucking happened? It was fucking snowblind. And so the first like 20 minutes of that fractal, I was just fucking AFK. I didn't do anything. I just fucking like, and I came back and we finished it and I got 80. But oh my God.
Okay, so how were fractals different? I will sum it up. The only difference was the agony actually stopped scaling after a certain point. So, and it one shot you anyway. Yeah. It one shot you no matter how much AR you had. So it was irrelevant. But what they did to make it harder was they made the mobs HP go up by a lot every level and their damage went up by a lot. So that even the shittiest trash mob would one shot you with its auto attacks. And it would also take you a very long time to kill even the shittiest trash mob. Everything one-shot you. So you had to bring like insane layers of defense to get through these. And the primary layer of defense that everyone used was blind, because blind would totally shut down trash mobs. However, that doesn't work on Dredge, or didn't work on Dredge. I think it does now.
Yeah, their eyes opened.
So the Dredge clown car would just spew Dredge at you for 45 minutes. And you would have to put weakness on them and have like a hammer guardian giving permaprot in order to survive, in order to not be one shot.
Weakness and permaprot.
Yeah. And you had to have perma reflex or else you instantly died. So you had to have perma reflex, you had to have perma weakness and permaprot just to not get one shot like by the mobs. So it was just 45 minutes of that. And it was insanely hard, And not just that, but like, every fractal is super hard. Like the one with the guys that with the fire shaman at the end that shoots the arrows at you.
Volcanic?
Yeah, volcanic. Those fire arrows, they pretty much one shot you now, but they were like super one shot then. And like all of those little shitty like fire slubs that shoot like at you, those all one shot you.
Nice.
Just insta one shot. And they also didn't die very fast because they had like a million HP each and power creep back then. Like everyone was doing like 7K damage. Like you had to have perma reflex like constantly. And you also had to dodge literally everything. So like if you had a bad player on your group, like it was just not possible. Wax packs. Not going to say anybody's name, he made it hard for me.
So. And that's when Nemesis came in, man. Like tanking the fractals on his cleric's guardian, right? You know? It's
He had a cleric guardian build, didn't he? I think he made one actually.
Yeah, he had a cleric. Yeah, it's called the immovable.
That was where the DPS uptime meme.
Yeah.
I hate that you mentioned wax packs because he's on like it's not that, like, it's beyond hate. It's beyond Like, there are people that I would legitimately say that I fucking, like, hate. Like, I feel absolutely nothing positive towards them, and I probably never would. But they're mostly real-life personalities. Because people in video games tend not to get me to that level. Because there's only so much harm someone can cause you in a game or online, believe it or not. Like, they can't hit you. They can't, like, abuse you as a child. They can't fucking do awful things to you. You can just turn the computer off and fucking walk away. believe it or not, like that's a strategy to handling that. But Wax Packs is on, he's like on the void list of people that I have just purged from my memory because I can't even, like, I don't want to fucking even think about him. Like, he's sealed away in the vault, like, to where I just can't deal with it. Because it was a combination of him being retarded, an asshole, and having the most goddamn fucking annoying voice. Like, think my voice, but, like, times, like, a multiple of 16. But it just gets worse every time you hear it. Because he was consistently more retarded, consistently more of an asshole, and then he got to the point where, like, he wasn't even trying. Like, yeah, every single action. But
can we get some context here? I think
so here's a guy, you know how like you hate guys who wipe the raid group and go haha XD, my mistake. He was that times 1,000.
Oh,
and then he would wipe the group like 10 times. And then like the one time he didn't wipe the group and someone else did, he'd be go, all right, guys, I think we really need to refocus here. We're losing focus. People aren't playing so good. We need to step it up. And like, he would try to give you like these pep talks and you were just like, dude, you're the cause of all the wipes. And he would just come up with dumb strats. Like when we were doing like, I think, it was a Codicus Manor Path 2 speedrun. The entire idea to do Codicus Manor Path 2 was his idea because he had like this great tactic. And like after like a day of trying his tactic, like no one wanted to do this speedrun. We quit. We didn't even use his tactic. Like we decided against using his tactic and we came up with a better strat. And like he like rage quit the run because we found a better strat than his, and we had to like get someone else. So he was just really hard to work with. And then he like had like a flame out rage where he like blamed everybody else for things. And then like came back later and apologized saying that he had like a mental health breakdown.
Oh,
like that old guy
should have had more of it
before. Like people like try to blame their bad behavior on like a breakdown that probably didn't happen, but
yeah.
He was just a
ooh. Wow. Well, there you have it. There was one other thing about fractals actually is that you couldn't do just one. They changed this a little bit. Of course, the fractals themselves were fairly significantly different in some cases.
You couldn't pick which one either.
Yes.
Yeah.
You could pick
your first one because you would.
Oh, yeah. You could reset the instance
so you got the first one you wanted, which was always swamp. But the second two would be RNG.
Hmm. Yeah, so you had three fractals, and it was, you know, you'd be at a set level and you'd get three fractals, and then there you go. You've got to get through all of them to get that set of fractals done. Now,
progression was character based.
Mm.
So if you, and again, I want to stress, when you got above level 50, you had to have perma reflex, had to. So if you didn't have someone in your group who wanted to play Guardian, and progress to 80. You didn't get to progress to 80 because you didn't have any way to get permareflex. So like you had to have Guardian like in your group. And so, and it was character based. So you had to have someone that wanted to do it on their Guardian.
Nice.
But you also had to have someone open the instance that was already at level. So like,
they hard capped it again. Like first it was soft capped at 50 and then you could use like revive orbs to survive the Jade Maw. And people got to 80 doing that. But then they fixed that. So the only way you could open up an instance higher than 50 was to have someone who had already done it the exploit way open the instance for you. And then you could progress.
Yeah, I wonder, why do you think they didn't like that? The fact that you could even do something like that.
I think they realized that the whole like making it harder by scaling the HP and the damage of the enemies was like not particularly fun.
Mm.
And I'm guessing that they had plans to make it more interesting. I guess that they wanted to expand it to 80 eventually or higher, but they wanted to have like make it fun, make it like skill based rather than like a grind. But they just never got around to it because ain't it.
Also, the reason why like a lot of us did you get to 80 like in the old days, Nike?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so like I don't know if it was for the same reason that I did, but like our group, the fractal change was coming, and we said, why don't we just get to 80 ahead of time? So whenever the like revamp comes, we'll already be there and we can just like play the content and we won't have to do it. But then ArenaNet decided that we needed fractal leaderboards.
Ooh.
And it wouldn't be fair so, if people were already at 80.
Yeah.
And so they reset everyone back to like, I think 30. Level 30.
Yeah.
Yes. And the best part, like, so, I mean, I understand it because the leaderboards got added to the game and like it was fair and like everything was fine. And it took people like months to get to fractal 50. And like you had your spot on the leaderboard. And like it was great. Like you could see
the leaderboards were players. So well implemented. Except really well
fucking,
done.
Except that fucking never happened. That never happened. They never added the leaderboards. People got to level fucking 50 fractal within like hours after the patch. And like
They reset everyone's progress for level.
Oh no. And then even well, I mean, Nike, do you want to tell us about the horror of what happened to you in Guild Wars 2 stream chat?
Yeah, I got banned after that patch when they were hyping the leaderboards and hyping the revamp. Like the patch came out and there was no leaderboard, so like they were doing like a guild chat or something or whatever the show was called at the time. And I just asked in chat, "Hey, where are the fractal leaderboards? When are they coming?" And I got banned. And it took like 2 years to get unbanned, so I had to ask the partner program people to have them unban me. So yeah, they didn't want to hear that. It was such a hot topic that they just banned people that asked. So like at that point, you were just like, if you asked where are fractal leaderboards or when are they coming, they would just ban you in their chat. Like that's how ANET controlled the narrative on fractal leaderboards. Like why talk about it when you can just try to ban everyone who talks about it?
Nice.
I mean, not only are they not ever coming, they're not even fucking breathing hard yet. Like that's
so
the thing.
Imagine, you know how ANET does those, like, play World v. World with the devs thing?
Yep.
That they do? Imagine if you went into that chat and you're like, hey, any idea when alliances are coming? And you just got banned.
Nice.
Like, that's, if you just asked that and you just got banned, that's exactly what it was like. Like, good lord.
All we wanted
to know is, are leaderboards coming? All we were like, are they coming? Yes or no?
It wasn't even
true. It took like a year for them to go, no, they're not coming. Why didn't you tell us that a year ago, that they're not coming? Like, holy crap. Like, is it so hard to just say, like, no, all they would have had to say is, yeah, we looked at it and we were looking at different ways to implement it and we realized that none of the ways were satisfactory. So we want to put our fractal energy into something else, like the development energy into something else, something better. Okay, cool. Instead, it was just like radio silence. That is ANET. Like instead of just saying that and pleasing everyone, it was just radio silence and just making people mad.
And the payoff came very late there, because of course it took a long time to get the, you know, the rework to a lot of the fractals, right, with level 100, right, and stuff like that. With the additional setup there and completely rework UI and stuff like that and a different system for the fractals. It took a little while, but yeah, that was a sad story, a tragic tale, one of many that will, you know, be happening during this stream, I suppose. But you know, then moving on, we then find ourselves in Heart of Thorns, and one of the big things in Heart of Thorns was right at the start, which was the content drought. And this was a bad time. This was a bad time for Guild Wars. I think we can all agree on that. Like, how long was it before they didn't really do anything?
A year and a half.
Year. I don't think it was that long. It was
like Living Story Season 3, Episode 1. I think it was 9 months.
Ooh.
After HOT.
Ooh.
And I remember Wooden Potatoes making a video before HOT going, HOT is going to come out, and then like 2 months later, they're going to hit the ground running with episode 1 of Living Story Season 3, and it was 9 months later. Ouch.
Like, that's, I understand, like, that's ideal, and that's what we want. But, like, Wooden Potato's problem is that he's just too happy.
Too happy.
And that doesn't translate well to the reality of ArenaNet. When I was fucking, like, I'm mad and angry And so, like, I would say stuff like, it's going to be a fucking year before you get anything. And, like, I end up being, like, more correct. It's like, I don't really want to be correct. It's like, please, just, like, this is what ArenaNet does. Like, this is the fucking company.
Well, I think the problem was, and from what I understand, ANET had no plans to do an expansion. They were not planning on doing Heart of Thorns until Daddy NCSoft said, you know, expansions make a lot of money, and we like that, and presumably you like that. So ANET dropped whatever they were doing and focused everything on Heart of Thorns. So while Heart of Thorns development was being rushed through, and it was rushed, there was no one working. There wasn't like a second team working on Living Story. It was literally all hands on deck for Heart of Thorns. Then Heart of Thorns came out, and presumably they started working on the Living Story, but Heart of Thorns needed another like patch after that. Once Colin, I guess I can't say he was fired because people get mad at me when I say that, but
Colin was fired.
Yeah. When Colin and the company went their separate ways, they had to stop what they were doing and do an entire revamp of the HRT maps. And that further prevented the Living Story from coming out. That was like a 2-month delay probably in Living Story.
Yeah. So, some internal struggles, right?
Yeah. So it was the type of thing where I think if they had just waited to release HOT by like 2 months and had like not every dev working on HOT, but had like at least one team of devs working on the first episode of Living Story, it could have been done a lot better. But they were kind of like, put everybody onto this. Okay, it's over. Take everybody off of it and then put them on everyone onto this. So it was just like putting out the fires. The fires were getting lit as fast as they could put them out, and there was no time to grow new content. Plus, you take away one of the raid teams and put them into Living Story.
Ooh, ouch.
To help make that
happen. Oh dear. Yeah, that's unfortunate. But you know, speaking of that, one thing that happened was a really big positive thing out of Heart of Thorns, right? Even after that drought, was the salvation, right? Finally, challenging group content. And this has got to be one of my fondest memories of the entire game, dude. Because look, okay, I was there, raids. I wasn't, you know, that was when I started properly playing Guild Wars 2, in my opinion, okay? I was playing with just people on the stream, some of the other YouTube content creators and stuff like that. You know, like the raid beta with the Veil Guardian when I believe Card got it down in the beta, actually, I believe.
Yes, they did.
They got it down in the beta.
And the squad UI was broken.
Oh, it was so completely
broken. Like once you got, if you got into the instance, you were fine, but then like no one else could get in.
Yep, that was good. Oh man, yeah, this has got to be some of the best memories in the game for me, certainly. Like Veil Guardian progression, it took us nearly a week to get him down, playing with different people every day. I was playing Power Reaper in the kill, I'm playing Knight's Power Reaper, just absolutely incredible. No one else could tank and I was playing Knight's Power Reaper. Oh man, like Veil Guardian, when I killed Veil Guardian, when I went to bed immediately after, so we were up for like 10 hours or something trying to get this fucker down, right? Okay, I went to bed and I could see the arena scorched into my eyes, and I thought, dude, that was good. Right, that was fucking insane, dude. Like, I was really, really. That was a big moment. It was a death smash. It was like a full, you know, that kind of thing. It was very, very high energy. That was absolutely awesome. And that was
the Wing 1 progression was like by far like the most hype for like any raid progression that I've done in this game by a lot.
Mm. Yeah. That was absolutely incredible. And the raid cadence, you know, we can move on a little bit, right? Was excellent.
Content drought. Because, like, the first three wings were during that 9-month period where no other content was coming. So, if it wasn't for, people were like, raids are the only thing getting updated. It's like, well, if it wasn't for raids, nothing would be coming out.
Exactly.
So it would be even worse.
Mm. Yeah. And we got, it was just 1, 2, 3, boom, boom, boom. Like, the cadence was absolutely incredible. You know, imagine if things had gone differently and raids continued on like that. What a different game.
And we were at like wing 13 by now.
Yeah. We'd have,
wing 14.
Maybe, something around that, right? Like literally double the amount of content, right? That would be incredible, right? It would be completely insane.
How was wing 1 for D&T? How much time you got, buddy? That could be its own podcast.
Oh dear! Oh my goodness!
Do we want to get into that? Why not?
It's a fun story. It's a fun story, yeah. And I don't think there's any salt around it anymore. I shouldn't think so, anyway. But do you want to tell the story?
The problem is, if I tell people what happened, people won't believe it, and they'll think that it's just me trying to cover my ass.
Here, I'll help you out with that. What Nike said, I have vague recollection of what he said when it happened, but my recollection of what he said at the time was definitely correct. And I think he's probably right still. Like, if he goes into the story, like, I think what he says is going to be 100% accurate. Okay. So I'm just going to get, and like, granted, like, Nike and I have had our differences and may still to
especially at that time.
Yes, especially yeah. at that time.
Okay.
I would just ask before you start, there is a certain individual.
Yeah, I'm not naming that individual's name. Perfect. When I do, I start getting creepy PMs. Yes, like out of like randomly. Yes. And like that person shall not be named for these reasons. I don't want like letters showing up to my house. Like
ooh.
Yeah.
Ooh.
Yeah, that's what yeah. So anyway, we took our NDA very seriously to the point where people in the Guild Wars 2 guild of D&T knew that people were testing, because it was like, well, why are these 9 people or 10 people not in the game? And then they all log into the game at the same time. Like when, like the people in the Guild Wars 2 guild, like knew what was going on, but we didn't talk about it on the forums. Like we didn't have like, it was not public within the guild. So you have to also remember that D&T was multiple games. Like there was like Wildstar and WoW and Marvel Heroes and Star Wars The Old Republic, like hundreds of people were involved in this organization. And the people that weren't in the Guild Wars 2 guild didn't give a shit about Guild Wars 2 or know about Guild Wars 2 or care about Guild Wars 2. So they didn't have any idea that we were raid testing. Zero idea. And we did all of our conversations about raid testing on a Telegram group on our phones. So it wasn't on the guild website at all. So people that might have been mods on the website had no idea we were testing, like zero idea. And then when the raid comes out and we clear it, they assumed, they had no idea that we were testing. They just assumed we cleared the raid in 20 minutes. So they were like, what the fuck? Like, and so... Yes, I did tweet the hashtag first thing, but that was like...
It's a joke, right?
But that wasn't like even claiming world's first. That was our first Gorsival kill. Gorsival's not even the last boss of the wing. Like, what the fuck? Like, anyway, and the problem was before that, when we killed Veil Guardian, which was before anyone else, I said, Veil Guardian down, and I tweeted that, and no one cared about that. Like, no one gave a shit, even though, like, we killed Veil Guardian, whatever. And I'll back up and tell something else before that. But anyway, the website, I didn't have control over the D&T website. I was not at all involved in the D&T website, nor was I involved in the D&T Twitter, like the actual guild Twitter. So when the actual website got a salt banner put up on it, and whenever the official D&T Twitter started tweeting out shit about Anet sucking and being bad at game design.
Ooh.
I didn't have any idea about that or know about it. But everyone in the Guild Wars 2 community assumes that I did and assumed that that was me, because they were not aware that D&T is a 300-person organization with different branches and different leadership who all had different access to different things. So... Everyone assumed it was me tweeting that. It was me that put the stuff on the website. I had no control about any of that. I didn't know what was happening. And so it kind of like suddenly blew up. We were in the middle of raiding. We were like raiding. We were going through for a second clear. And like all of a sudden people were like, our phones like started blowing up with like emails, like going, people were like, what the fuck? And it was just like completely a surprise to us that even all that was going on. And it was just because the other people in the guild from the other branches had no idea that we were testing. So they assumed Anet comes out with a raid on a game whose reputation is easy content and D&T clears it in 20 minutes. So of course they're going to meme about it because that's what you do when that happens. And they memed about it and they had no idea. So it blew up and that was a problem. And I don't think anyone in the raid community cared, which was the other thing, or whatever, because they knew we weren't eligible for World First anyway, because it was already a forum thread a month before the raid came out saying DNT and Attuned are not eligible for World First. So that was like completely cleared up. So it didn't matter what anyone said, we weren't eligible for World's First. So it didn't matter at all. Like it was like, and everyone who mattered knew that. So like if you were in Snow Crows or in NA or whatever the other, and I forget who else was competing for World's First with those two guilds, you knew that. So it wasn't like a slight against you or anything like that, because we were not in the competition with them to speak of.
Yeah, for what it's worth, that's always how it seemed to me. A little bit of a misunderstanding, right? I mean, I thought it was quite funny, right? It was, you know, it was really funny, and it was regrettable how that turned out. Obviously, you know, people took it maybe a little too seriously and didn't really understand the full context. And well, I don't know. It is what it is, right? That's just how some of these things go sometimes, you know. And yeah.
I mean, and then you have Anet that allows it to go on by when they did remove us from the testing thing, they put a thread up in the forums. Ooh, instead of like putting the thread up and then like closing it and making like no comments allowed, they left the comments go on for 8 pages. And you can imagine how positive those comments were. There were no harsh words said in a mean tone in any of those comments. So for some reason, like you can go on the Guild Wars 2 forums and you can say, I disagree with your ideas for a couple of substantive reasons, which I'll get into later. And they'll delete that and ban you from the forums for being argumentative. But you can say literally the most vile things, including death threats to people in that particular thread. And it was A-okay, which is why I dislike that guy Seshi specifically.
Yes.
Because he's a piece of shit. And he said some things that were completely vile in that thread. So... yeah, I hope whatever girlfriend pillow he's currently ejaculating into treats him well, because that's probably the only closest thing to human contact he's ever gonna have.
Okay,
so I guess I'll jump in at this point and say, Nike absolutely had no control over the DNT Twitter. But the DNT Twitter was automated to a degree where it would retweet everything on like a white list of people. Like Nike's Twitter was on it, like my Twitter was on it, like a couple other people. So it would just like bot retweet those. So like, I don't know if that contributed to thinking that like maybe like Nike, like I didn't have any access to it. Nike didn't have any access to it. I was not at the time, because I had already left the guild. But I was at one point for a while, actually, an admin on the website. And like...
and Billy's website. I guess
and Billy's website. Rest in peace, dear brother. Man, what a tragedy. Like, the other guilds, like the Wildstar Guild. I don't remember if the Star Wars Guild ever did any testing or anything. But like the Wildstar Guild just had like... threads on their forums that like you had, like you could have access to if you had a certain permission. They would talk about like NDA shit on there, which I guess was mostly fine. The problem is that like people like me that had like global admin and like a couple other ranks could see all of that, and like I didn't really give a shit, but like it wasn't just confined to only them. But like Nike didn't have, as far as I remember, didn't have any like admin access to the website. I think he just had like Guild Wars 2 officer and maybe like some degree of global access, but it wasn't like he couldn't get in and like make any edits or fucking like do anything. I think he could delete threads in like the Guild Wars 2 forum. But like, yeah, there were a couple of people that, like, the best way that I could put it, of some of the like people that were a little bit jaded, maybe, is like the website owner told me at one point, like he was one of the OG WoW guys. He said, imagine all your friends that you used to play games with quit the game, quit playing with you, quit talking with you, except for a couple, and then you ran a community for the next 10 years, and there were people that acted like children, pissy crybabies, like people that stuck around and like wanted to do what you did. And it's just a shit show, but you did it anyways, because it was kind of like you felt like you were contributing to something big. And so like he was very cynical, and there were a couple of people that were very cynical. And so like that's where like the self-memeing came from. For, like, if a raid boss dies in a forest and no one is like there to hear it, does it make a sound? Like meme shit like that, like the banner on the website, like Nike didn't have anything to do with any of that. But
and I will say, someone brought it up in chat, we did have a no e-dating rule in our guild. Yeah, because the e-dating almost destroyed the guild. Like, it was just like on EU for a while there. Oh, it was worse than EU.
Yeah.
I could, I'm not going to name names, but they went on to become guild leaders of other prominent NA raiding guilds.
Yeah.
Where they had three-way Skype masturbation sessions. Ooh. And they weren't always two girls.
That's all I'm going to say. All right.
So, there was a lot of, like, everything was cool. Then at like 10 or 11 p.m., I would go to bed. And the second my head hit the pillow and I fell asleep,
she would get wild.
The kids started having circle jerks on Skype.
Ooh.
Like,
ooh.
So eventually we just had to say, look, if you can be in the guild, but you can't date each other. You can have girlfriends outside the guild, but they can't be in the guild.
Yeah. That was one of the things that really annoyed me for a long time, because like here's the thing about Brazil. Brazil is the fucking axe from heaven. And whenever Brazil catches a scent at the very tip of his nostril that somebody or some people are going to be a problem, the axe swings and it is eliminated swiftly and brutally. It's not a good clean cut. It's fucking like blood splatter. Yeah. Like
I want to say, I also have forgiveness in my heart.
Yeah, I don't try to hold grudges.
Well, this is where me and Brazil had our disagreement. Was that Brazil goes, the following people need to be kicked from the guild, and he gave me a very long list, and I was like, look, I can't kick out half the people in the guild. Like, we got to give them a chance, and of course they fucked me over, and they all ended up leaving anyway. To have their own e-dating guild, but like Brazil was right. I'll give him credit on that. Those people should have been kicked like immediately.
The e-date, the infest. There's always been a rich history of ERP in Guild Wars 2. Like it is certainly an infestation, right? It's, you got human females, dungeons, right? Like there's a lot of stuff that encourages it, I guess. But you know, now it's a shame that, well, I guess Final Fantasy was around then, I guess, right? It's a shame we didn't just tell them to go play that instead, right? So they can go and ERP in that game and leave everyone else just playing Guild Wars 2.
Generally speaking.
Yeah, they didn't. They were like, I don't want, I guess I don't know. I'll just say that I know some information about the personal lives of some of those people. And like, I'm not the kind of asshole that would release it and talk about it. But I'll just say, like, between doing absolutely nothing meaningful in real life and also having a lack of content in Guild Wars 2, like, there's only so much of a void that can exist without finding extracurricular activities to begin to fill it with.
Yeah, I mean, you can duo a raw a lot of times, but then, like, when you can duo a raw and
ELP.
Have, like, sexy talk at the same time, that becomes content. That's like all new content. That's like a challenge mode that
playing one-handed kind of meme. You know, it's
Do you think Goku was practicing that fingerless solo for no reason?
Yeah, I mean, like, that's he's, you know, it's all for a good cause, right? You know, you've got to practice those mechanics, like one finger Lupicus, right? Like, it's, you're very, very busy with the other hand, but. I think it's time to move away from this, because you know what was happening at the same time of HOT and kind of met its peak in Heart of Thorns was esports as well, was PvP, right? We had our pro league.
Grouch.
Well, the man was hoisting Guild Wars 2 onto his back, right? He did his best. The dungeon tournament The ERP, the first ERP.
World Seasons were his baby too.
Well, I actually didn't know that, but there you go. World versus World, he's trying to go for it. And then finally, of course, PvP as well, the Esports League, the World Tournament Series. And this was going on during Heart of Thorns, but a few things did get in the way, didn't they? And the first of which is, of course, the Clown Fiesta. That was Heart of Thorns balance that did not really get addressed very well. And particularly with regards to the bunker meta revolving around Chronomancer. Because back in the day, guys, Chronomancer used to have a well, a precognition that would give you blur, I believe. And you could just stand on point just forever and ever, spamming blocks and distortion with Minstrel Amulet. And as soon as you cap the point, they could not get you off it, no matter what. And the famous thing here is, of course, is that there were apparently sponsors looking to get in on Guild Wars 2 and add more money to the scene, bringing in cash, right? All those funds to the game. And they saw the gameplay and pow. They were saying, no, fuck this. We're not going anywhere near this. Like, it got so bad to the point I recall watching some Pro League. And it was obviously incredibly boring, but around 5 minutes into the game, one player was somehow able to get a cap. And then the entire enemy team said GG and left. It's like they didn't, 1 point, and they instantly left.
I remember in that, my memory of that era was a lot of games finished when the timer ran out, and they weren't even close to 500 points. It was like 250 to like 100 when the timer ran out, and it was like, good Lord, because no one was dying and no one was really capping points. Like, it was crazy.
Yeah, that was a true joy. You know, it's, what do you guys think? I want to get a take on this, because I was quite optimistic about the esports, right? Like, they did eventually fix these issues. And of course, there were some stumbling blocks, I imagine, with the game being very uninteresting for a while. But, you know, you actually got Pro League. Then you had Vermillion, you had Denial, right? You had Orange Logo, like they're at rank 55, right? You know, a bunch of teams. The Abjord, obviously a very famous team as well. But you had all these teams going, and you know, it was actually kind of building, right? Like, you had this tournament series, you had 10,000 viewers watching the esports, and then they just dropped it, right?
Advertising budget went in different directions.
Severance packages. At the payout of those separations.
What are you talking about, Brazil? He didn't get fired. Oh. Comments are going to let you know that.
Yeah, right. No one ever gets fired from ArenaNet. Well, until it's just half the company at once.
Yeah. But I kind of, to push it a little bit, though, like, what's your take on that? Like, with regards to, do you think PvP could have made it? Could it have made it?
Yeah, they just had to keep that budget. Like, they've gotten much better at, like, the speed of balance patches. Like, they might not, the balance patches themselves might not be as extreme as I think we would like, but they've at least gotten to the point where they're doing one every 3 months or faster. And there was a couple balance patches there where it was like a month and a half between them. But that's what they needed to have then. But it really, it's just advertising budget. Like, that was how they were marketing the game. And I have to imagine they looked at their player base and they said that, like, the type of people who log in, do their dailies, and play Living Story are not at all interested in esports. Mm. And when we advertise through Google AdSense, like, just like banner ads on websites, which is, from what I understand, like the most of their advertising budget, that draws in casual players that want to play MMO that's free to play. Mm. And that's who they've decided to put the money behind, and probably it did bring in more players to do Google AdSense than to do a $250,000 Google AdSense campaign versus a $250,000 LAN event. It probably brought in more players and more money. But in a perfect world, they'd have both, and you would try to bring in Omega players, bring in them all, bring in the hardcores and the casuals, like, bring them all in.
Do you not think, though, that the esports scene could have built up, though, and eventually have become more cost-effective, more of a long-term investment?
It would have if Grouch had stayed with the company, I believe.
Yeah.
Like, whatever Amazon was paying him, they should have just matched it, and he probably would have stayed. or give them a job title.
A really big loss to the company, right? Like I in every game mode, not just PvP, right? Like literally every game mode felt the effect suffering by not having Grouch. Absolutely, yeah.
Or, you know, maybe hire someone to replace him to fulfill the same job role. It didn't even have to necessarily be Grouch. It could just be someone whose job was to do that. He was the head of competitive. Who's the head of competitive now? There isn't one. So, Ben P is probably the closest thing to the head of competitive. But I guarantee you, if you ask Ben P for 100,000 gems to do a major PvP tournament, he would say he couldn't do it. So, like, I mean, so he's not really the he's not the same role as Grouch.
I have nothing good stuff to say about Grouch. You know, I remember like there are these two instances. I asked for gems for Mystic builds. The partner program said no. I asked gems for the ERP. The partner program said no. Grouch approached me about Mystic builds, actually. Somehow he must have caught the stream at one point, right? He approached me for feedback on Stronghold because I kind of liked the game and I thought it was pretty good, right? Okay. Unfortunately, he never was able to get anything done with regarding Mystic builds or Stronghold. But again, the one thing that did come through was, of course, the ERP. You know, this was on advice from Nike, actually, of course, because Nike did the same thing with his dungeon tournament, the DNT
again,
dungeon tournament.
He approached me to see how he could help with the dungeon tournaments. Not the other way, not me begging for anyone at ANN to listen. Grouch was like, we are interested in this. We want to support this. How can we support it? Like that, he was the one who reached out to find that.
Yeah, it was a massive blow to the company. And to be honest, that sort of thing, it probably was the beginning of the end for PvP and competitive with regards to Guild Wars 2. Now, you know what is a really big problem, though, with Guild Wars 2 PvP during Heart of Thorns is it didn't have the system that we had in place now. Like, I genuinely think that if Guild Wars 2 had had ATs, stuff like the monthly ATs and the daily ATs in, and maybe even stuff like the 2v2 and the current rank system with the rating, who would have thought it? Showing actual, you know, ELO or MMR in your rank system is a good idea. You know, a ring that took, 5 years to catch on to that, I think? that would have been huge, right? That could have maybe kept it going.
If you had automated tournaments at a time where there was a big enough player base to, like, make matchmaking decent, which there would have been at that point, like, there would have been good matchmaking at right after Heart of Thorns. And if you had automated tournaments and then the monthly win, like the monthly tournaments culminated in the annual like world championships with a big cash prize, like the community would have been like insanely hyped. I think like if they had thought, like if they could have had a crystal ball, they would have just put, instead of doing Stronghold, they would have put that development effort into the automated tournaments instead.
You're completely wrong. I'm sorry. If they had a crystal ball, they would have released mounts 3 years early.
That's true.
Yeah. Oh my god. No. Why would you in the gem store? What's funny? Like the thing that really did entertain me is that when they cancelled Pro League, they didn't say they cancelled Pro League. As I understand it, even the literal winners, which is Denial, Hellsith, and his boys, right? They didn't know that there wasn't going to be Pro League season 2. Right, they were like, yeah, we're so fucking ready. We're gonna get better. We're gonna go harder. Right, we're gonna build the scene. Isn't it kind of funny that ArenaNet these gamers like who dedicated a huge amount of time, they were flying all over the place, competing in these live tournaments at Gamescom.
A lot of them were planning on quitting their jobs to be professional gamers.
Guild Wars 2 gamers.
Well, it's the same thing with the Fractal leaderboards. Like
they just didn't say.
When they don't want to talk about it, like when instead of just saying no and explaining why, like, hey, it's a budget reason, we can't afford to do another Pro League, sorry, we're getting rid of it. It's just radio silence. Like that, it's the same pattern that we saw before with the Fractal leaderboards. It's just, they don't, it's like, no one enjoys having uncomfortable conversations with people.
Oh, of course.
I don't enjoy it. No one wants to have an there are some social assassins who do like to have uncomfortable conversations to make people like uncomfortable. But like most non-sociopaths they're discomforted by having uncomfortable, especially confrontational ones. So, but ain't it, a corporation should be an amoral non-entity that doesn't have emotions.
That's correct. 100%.
So a company should have no problem going, we're not doing this initiative anymore because it's not part of our company strategy anymore. Conversation over. You don't have to cry about it. You don't have to hug it out. Like, that's just the end. But instead, they just say nothing. It's just because, like, who wants to be the one to say it? Like they don't even just say it. Just the communication was bad.
There's a correct way to do greed and narcissism when you're Mr. Corporate, when you're Mr. Corporation. But like, the problem is that like, Mr. Corporation greedy narcissist like doesn't understand the people that are just fucking like weak-willed and just pissy and crybabies, because like, they don't know how to deal with that, because there's no way to deal with that. There are people that you can never please, and the incorrect thing to do is to try and appease them and pacify them and waste time on solutions to do that. Because like the issue with people like that is that their ego is on the line constantly. Like that's how they feel. Like it's just like their ego versus the world. And so they're trying to save their ego from those people. And the correct thing to do is to isolate those people, remove those people, and then have everyone else inflate your ego because you're saving the fucking community. Like that's how you handle that situation. That's how Mr. Corporation went. But like there is, you can be a narcissist and you can be Mr. Corporation and be low functioning. And I think that's really the problem with the reading.
Oh dear.
I think they're just low functioning and just shit at what they do.
Wow.
Like, they have the toolbox, but they can't use it.
I'll tell you, let's talk about that a little bit, because perhaps one of the reason behind some of these decisions getting made was to do with, Mr. Colin Johansson, because, you know, he was at the company and then he did end up departing for whatever reason. And the replacement was MO, Mike O'Brien. Some people did, you know, unfortunately say half expansion Mike. That was what happened. But you know what? I don't think he really deserved that, because he came in with Heart of Thorns and he instituted this completely, like, you know, when it's ready, we ship it, then we talk about it policy. That was really big on his agenda. And of course, he fixed Heart of Thorns. You know, he really did. He absolutely fixed Heart of Thorns. Like, you know, a lot of the issues with regards to the maps, the reward structure with the maps, that all got fixed. Bugs got fixed as well. So he did a lot of really good work pushing that stuff.
Fractals were unplayable at HOT, which is another thing that people forget. You did swamp 3 times, and that was your fractal experience. Oh, daily resets here. We're going to do Swamp in Tier 2, Swamp in Tier 3, Swamp in Tier 4. All right, we're done with Fractals for the day. Catch you guys later. That was fun. Fractals were unplayable trash at HRT launch, and he fixed it. So that's why people thought he did such a good job, at least in the community that I was in. We were like, oh my God, here's a guy who listens and fucking fixes the problem. This guy needs to run the show more often.
Yeah. So to a certain extent, like, he did absolutely come in and, you know, hard carry the game and like get it back on track. The trouble was is that the communication that he instituted was less than desirable, I think, and led to a lot of unrest. And well, it does to this day, right? This is something that is happening right now, right? Like, they're improving, to be fair. You know, ArenaNet, they are improving. They definitely are. And you know, even with this big announcement coming up, right, which is awesome. The Reddit AMAs, like, what happened to that? Like, that used to happen, but then I guess Jessica Price happened, and they
Jessica Price,
and then they don't.
She is a man after my own heart.
Yeah.
Again, that's another example of Anet not wanting to have an uncomfortable conversation, so they just cancel the conversation.
Yeah.
Like, we don't want to answer questions about this topic, so we're just going to not talk. And go silent after every patch. Okay.
Oh.
That just fits your MO. There we go.
We probably I'm not sure if we should really tell that story, but well, actually maybe we should. We can tell the JP story, but you know what story I want to hear first, actually? This is a good one. I want to hear the Legendary Armor story from Brazil, actually. Yeah. Because, of course, Legendary Armor was one of the... Oh, I tell you what. I forgot to mention this in my opening story. Do you know what my first major video on Guild Wars 2 was? That was actually like a proper serious video. I made a video talking about what's next for Guild Wars 2, right? And I believe this was in 2014, I think. And it said, legendary armor, 500 like 500 chef and stuff like that, and like big reworks to well, I can't remember what else to say. Yeah, legendary crafting, right? Okay, and I was detailing and analyzing a post that ArenaNet made, right? And then of course it took well 1 year twice, right, for legendary armor. It was supposed to be coming soon, but oh well, yeah, maybe not. And then yeah, legendary armor was one of the big things. It was actually a big feature part of Heart of Thorns, right? And that dropped. It was supposed to, well, I think it was originally predicted to be after Wing 3, you know, the closure.
It was supposed to be.
Yes. The Spirit Veil, right? It ended up being in Bastion. It was well integrated into Bastion of the Penitent, actually, to be fair to them. It was well done.
It didn't ship even with Bastion of the Penitent.
No, it didn't. It shipped
3 months after Bastion of the Penitent.
Yeah, because you couldn't get the tree, right? Could you?
You can imagine our disappointment when Wing 3 comes out and you can't finish your legendary armor, because everyone thought Wing 3 were getting legendary armor. And we didn't. And we were pissed. We were like, okay, well, at least Wing 4 will get our legendary armor. And then Wing 4 ships, and you can't get your legendary armor. Oh my god, I cannot imagine how many people quit the game quit the raid community, at least.
It's a lot like Coalescence, Big L. Oh my god. Holy shit, Coalescence is a fiesta as well. But Brazil, take it away. Tell us about legendary armor.
I don't really even know where to start with this, because there's just fucking so much. So, like, ultimately, this was a really good example of them just biting off way more than they could chew. And I think it was because someone told a group of people, like, go make legendary armor. And so, like, I guess in no particular order, you have stuff like Paul Ella. I'm not meaning to like go on this like assassination against you, but I just got to say, like, I've got some problems. I got some problems with you. Like, I don't hate you. I've just got some fucking problems with you, because like you have this live stream showcasing the armor, and there's just like, thinking back on it and having watched it again, like, he almost looks surprised and confused whenever he, like, tried to dye the armor and talk about how the glow, like, was dyeable and how it stayed. And that didn't happen. And they kind of, like, cut away from it. It was, like, I think there was some cute confusion. Like, there was shit that, like, probably just wasn't finished. Or, like, I don't know how the, like, back-end development of, like, the models and skeletons was. But, like, I started to dig into this because I was fucking mad. Because you can't dye the glow and like the particle effects on the legendary armor. So I just thought, like, maybe you just can't do that. Like, maybe the technology for that like isn't in the game somehow. And then I go way back and find the COF armor from fucking beta with dyeable fire glow. You could dye all of the fire lava on that armor. Like, there was a person with like green armor. Like, the picture is probably still around. You could probably find it. But like, and there was like, there's stuff now, obviously, that has dyeable particle effects and dyeable glows and all of this shit. And that wasn't on the armor. This is like the most prestigious shit, like, fucking in the game, and it's not there. And like, you have the trench coat on the medium armor. And the excuse for the trench coat being on the medium armor is that you have to have characters' silhouettes so you know what they are. But the problem with that is that there are outfits that anyone can put on any character of any class, of any level, of any race, and make them, you can make a Mesmer look exactly the same as a warrior.
Well, and there's also standard models in PvP. So
which
you
can't, which, like, yeah.
Yes.
You can't even say that has anything to do with PvP.
Yeah, and also the shittiest part of the medium armor is that the trench coat is not there until you you draw your weapon out. The trench coat literally like materializes and appears. And so it's just like, you've got to be fucking kidding me. And like, you've got shit like the 1 year twice, like whenever he said, like in that interview, it was like, well, it wasn't really 2 years. No, it was 2 years. Fuck you. Like, sorry, but like, fuck you.
To be honest, I've got to defend Paul there. To be honest, I don't think he had any choice to say that stuff. Like, this is company policy.
He may not have.
You know, I don't think anyone. I don't think that anyone at Arena even buys like the outfit shit. Like, come on. And you know, Paul was making the best of a bad situation. Let's be honest, right? Like, at that point, it was at the time when the raid team was probably getting chipped away at, right, and being borrowed by other teams, right? Like, raids started to slow down. It was 1-2-3. Wings 1-2-3 was Speedmaster, right? But then Bastion was a bit slower, and then Wing 5 was, ooh, you know, and then Wing 6 was, ooh, and then Wing 7, ooh, oh dear. So it was probably, you know, low resources, and, you know, it's company line, right? You've got to toe the company line, I suppose, at some point. So, you know, that must have stung from his perspective as well, to be honest with you.
Yeah, he may have been. So here's the thing, like, I'll continue with this as well. Like, the armor, you could go in and like the helmet or like the shoulders of the gloves, the pieces that you can like uncheck and like turn invisible. Like, you could go spam click the checkbox and the map would like reload all of the effects like really fucking fast, and you would just flood people's like computer, and it would crash them out of the zone, and it would crash your game. And this was addressed. Like, people found out about this real quick and like made a point of it. And then I don't remember if it was Paul, but like a dev or multiple devs said that this wasn't an issue. They said that that wasn't true. So I decide, you know what, I'm going to go ahead and fucking record this happening, and I'll just upload a video of it, because it absolutely is true. And turns out, like, that was just another example of dishonesty. But, like, the thing is, like, maybe he was forced to say that. But you have to understand, like, if you're forced to say something and you're forced to lie and you're forced to, like, put yourself in a position like you're doing shit like that and you hate it, it's time to submit your resume to other companies and start looking. And then your 2 weeks notice comes. Like, because you don't just sit around and deal with that shit. You're dealing with a company who doesn't give a fuck about you, and you're just fucking weak mentally and think you have to take it. And then you just get fired anyways when NCSoft mandates that you fire half the fucking company, because it turns out they don't give a shit about their employees and they don't fucking care. And it's just this like weird ass like policy about like, I don't even know how to describe it at this point. Like, fuck.
It is ironic, like Teapot says, he took one for the team and they paid him back in like the worst possible way you could pay someone back for taking one for the team.
Oh, that was pretty sad.
Here's the thing, like, quitting a job, you have to understand that if you're not wanted somewhere and things are shitty, like, maybe you have expenses, maybe you have a car payment, maybe you have rent, maybe you have all this shit going on.
It's family as well, right? You know?
Sure. Maybe you have friends. Maybe you have friends there.
Man, it's a big maybe.
But, like, interestingly enough, there are other places to work. And interestingly enough, you don't just have to ghost a company and disappear and then lose your car and lose your apartment or house and, like, all the. You can start looking for other things. And you can fucking go do something else. You say, thank you, I've had a good time at this company, I appreciate the opportunity, but somewhere
else.
That's...
You line the job up while you're still working there. Yes. So that it's way not... you can go, all right, 2 weeks notice, catch you guys later.
Yeah, it's not like you're working at McDonald's and a customer gets mad at you, and so you just take your hat and throw it on the floor and walk out. Like, it's a different environment than that, believe it or not.
Well, I'll tell you what, I think that's enough of that. Let's talk about I'm conscious that the show is getting a little bit long, and, you know, there's something special coming up soon. But I do want to talk very briefly about Living Story Season 3, right? And to be honest, I look, guys, I'm genuinely not making this up, okay? I'm not fucking around. But I don't really have a particularly good recollection of Living Story Season 3. I just didn't find it particularly memorable.
I liked it. I thought it was better than 4. I think the map design was way good. Like when Bloodstone... Fen or whatever the map is called first came out, and people were like, oh my god, this map is vertical. And it had like the craziest graphics with like the red shit and the shit floating. Like that was like mind blowing, that map.
Yeah.
Like that design was like the best map design, like in terms of like visual style that they had ever come out with. Like, and it really like took advantage of the gliding and the mastery system. Like it was just, that was probably the best map that they've done in the Living Story.
Oh yeah. I tell you what, I did actually, no, I remember now. It's just been a while. I've got to, you know, get the old noggin jogging. That was premature. No, I do remember exactly what happened now. It was the Lazarus meme. And I think I will have to completely agree with Nike. A lot of those maps were absolutely top tier. A big part of my daily routine used to be doing the dailies for these maps, right? And it was fun. It was satisfying, right? Some of them were maybe not so great. I mean, Lake Doric was a little bit weird. But there, you know, there was still stuff to do there. And Bloodstone Fen, Ember Bay, Draconis Mons, hey, even Bitterfrost, right? Like this is some really good content, right? And rewarding content as well, right? A lot of the open world definitely took some serious strides in the way it was designed there. I think people were, they were clamoring for that big meta event, right? That was the thing, right? They were clamoring for that big boss to fight, and that didn't really ever get developed on. It was more like mini games, mini activities, and then the big bosses were in the story. But it was certainly a spectacle a lot of the time, you know, like when you see a giant fucking Primordus, right? When you're fighting Lazarus, then you got the, you know, the epic like troll reveal as well, leading into Path of Fire. You know, that was Living Story season 3 was good. Like it's a real shame it didn't come out faster. I mean, I think, you know, it was obviously took a little while to get all the content, but the actual mechanically the maps were solid, the story instances and the spectacle was certainly solid. Like it was certainly a case of the team just flexing the art, right? Like some of the environments were just absolutely like unbelievable. Like for me, the standout is actually Draconis Mons. I know a lot of people hate that map, but that map is fucking incredible. Actually, that map is actually amazing. Like such a varied, diverse, and beautiful spectacle. Arena did a good job. They, you know, if there's one thing you can never criticize ArenaNet for, right? It is environment design. And giving you something to look at and show off. Like they're really, 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 really good at this. And, you know, even though Timey was there, okay, squealing, going crazy, it was pretty fucking epic to see like a big ass Primordus head, right? Oh yeah, that was pretty good. That was pretty good. You know, it's good times, man. Not bad.
Season 3 was so much better than season 4, and it wasn't that season 4 was like worse. Like if anything, the quality got better in season 4. But season 3 was so successful that it became like this template that they couldn't break away from.
And it ended up being repetitive. Like, yeah.
Look how good season 3 is. We just need to keep doing that. And they just did it a few too many times. And it ended up becoming stale because they kept repeating that.
Yeah.
But it doesn't mean that season 3 was bad. It just means that it stayed at the party too long. Like it wasn't. Season 4 wasn't unique enough.
Precisely, right? The same template, the same design, one map, hearts, blah, 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 blah. It bled into season 4. So, and the thing is with season 4, it was kind of, the maps were like obsolete on release to a certain extent, right? Like there were some achievements and some unique rewards, but a lot of grinding out like HOT was very effective still, right? It was still very effective. And it did recover, right? Of course, Big L's pointing out Dragonfall here in season 4. Dragonfall was a bit of a return, you know, a return to form there. But even that, like for me, I think it did lack the punch of a big final boss fight, right? Like compare Dragonfall to Dragon Stand, right? You know what I mean? Like it's a different ball game, right? And of course, resources are not quite there, I suppose, which is why that ended up happening, but a shame to be sure. But you know what, season 3, for all its delays and unfortunate delivery schedule, I think is I kind of feel bad for, you know, not really having a good enough recollection. I guess I just wasn't paying attention. That's my fault. No, I definitely was.
One thing I want to say is I would love to know what their original intention with White Mantle and Lazarus was.
Yeah.
Because I definitely do feel like at some point in the story, they did want Lazarus to come back and actually revive the Mursaat and have the White Mantle and basically fight Guild Wars. Like, I think that that was probably at some point in their narrative iteration process, like the story. And then at some point, like, it was like they abruptly decided, no, we're not going to actually bring Lazarus back. Haha, it was a ruse all along. The God of War who doesn't deceive people was deceiving you the entire time. Like, that it was a bit like they fired somebody. Like, I don't know, but it felt like they changed head writers halfway through. And the new writer had like a completely different story he wanted to tell.
They probably had someone working on it that was wearing a cowboy hat in their Twitter profile.
Ooh. Well, that's coming up in a little bit, of course. But yeah, definitely that arc was not, perhaps not handled that well. You know, our expectations were certainly subverted, but I don't think it was in a good way. The White Mantle would have been a very interesting story to explore. And it already happened in the raids, right? Like, which was, you know, really exciting. And having the raids tied to the story in that respect, I think was really cool as well. You know, it would definitely gave it a bit more oomph when you're playing through that raid. And it made the game feel connected and a whole, right? A whole game. So it's...
Yeah. Instead of, like, an interesting story with a villain who had motivations and had a real reason to be mad at humans. They switched gears to an elder dragon that has no emotions. Like,
yeah,
I think had they just kept on the track of Lazarus coming back and like trying to revive the whole Mursaat race, like that would have been, and POF was like that. That would have been so good. Like, I don't know.
Well,
but I think it was better storytelling potential, at least. And the POF story wasn't bad, I guess.
Oh, no. We've kind of reached Path of Fire, and, you know, it makes sense. Like, regardless of everything that happened to PvP and World Bus as well, like, you know, like, who the fuck cares, dude? It's already dead at that point. But, nah. You know, with the story that happened, you know, it was solid. You know, it was enjoyable to play through it. My only criticism of the Path of Fire story is that I felt that it kind of... It ended very quickly, right? A little bit abruptly, right? There was not much build up. It's just like, oh yeah, we're gonna go kill Balthazar. We're taking him down, right? So that happened. No, it was well done. And you know what? To be fair to them, the Balthazar boss fight is pretty fucking epic. Actually, I think people don't remember it because there was no migraine mode, which is whatever they would have called it, right? There should have been.
Imagine
right?
if the reward for the migraine mode was you get that badass fiery greatsword skin. Oh,
nice!
Anywhere in the game, even on the gem store. How is that not on the gem store? What is Aenet thinking?
Mm.
That like fiery greatsword was amazing skin. Why is that not? How is that not the legendary greatsword? Like, I don't know.
It is in the gem store. So apparently someone's saying it's in the gem store.
You guys are thinking of the Balthazar sword. I'm thinking of this thing, the actual fiery greatsword that you pick up at the end, and it has like the most insane particle effect trail. It's definitely not the same one. There is the Balthazar. Yeah, so Hothan.
Yeah.
Yeah, but it's a buffed Sohothan.
It's a mega one, yeah. It's not just fiery dragon.
Yeah, it's like a mega Sohothan.
Yeah.
I have to find it because I don't even remember what it looked
Wait,
like.
Wait, it's in the game? Is it in the game? I don't know. Wait, is it?
No, yeah, you can get the one from the Guild Wars 1 Hall of Monuments. That's not the same one.
Yeah, it's totally different.
There's a much better one.
No, it's very different. No. Fiery Dragon Sword is not...
Low IQ.
Fiery Dragon Sword is not even close to like the explosiveness of Sir Hothan in the final instance. But yeah, there you go. Yeah, it was a good fight. It's a shame that it didn't have that. But you know, that the lack of migraine mode, I suppose, is something that we really ought to talk about, is the transition from Guild Wars 2 being very multiplayer focused and replayable content over to effectively solo content. Path of Fire really doubled down, right? It was a complete 180 from Heart of Thorns. You know, everything was just play at once. It was a content expansion, but, you know, you play through it all immediately. That's the trouble. And then there's nothing to repeat after that. You know, it's after you were done with Path of Fire, you just went back to doing Heart of Thorns, raids and dungeons and fractals, right? It was a bit, okay. Unfortunate. But yeah, that change, that shift, I think was the beginning of the end for well, for my guild anyway. This is where we get to the sad part. Like, we're actually going to cut the sad part. We're not getting to this, guys. We're only doing like the, we're getting to the end of the history, right? Okay, like we're not going to go any further because then it
starts.
We're
going to end at the end of Wing yeah. 5.
Oh, Wing 5, boys.
Yeah. We all get our Doom CM.
Yeah,
kill,
Doom
like
CM. Progression.
Since Wing 1, and then that's where we are right now.
It's such a paradox, right? They were obviously working on Wing 5 before Path of Fire came out. I would imagine. I can only imagine because it's
probably supposed to ship with it or close to it.
Wing 5 is the anti Path of Fire, right? Like, let's just get into it, right? Like, Wing 5 was the fucking shit, boys. That was hard content, Doom CM, brutal, uncompromising difficulty. Certainly some of the biggest hype that I've ever experienced in the game was Wing 5 release Doom. You've got players, you've got 1UP in the chat, you've got Target in the chat saying, how the fuck do you beat this, right? You know, everyone's like, how do you beat Doom? How can you even do this? And the same for Doom CM. It was amazing. It was fucking godlike. That was certainly the peak of the raid scene, right? Even though it was quite a slow, you know, it was late in the day, right, for when this win came out. That was epic. Like, that actually restored so much hope, I think. But then, well, Wing 6. It took a while to get Wing 6. But yeah, Wing 5 got people excited. Like, oh my god, like this, you know, raiding in Guild Wars 2, this is what it can be, right? Yeah, it was only two bosses. Statues, yes, fuck statues. But River of Souls is kind of okay. Just ignore statues, and Wing 5 is fucking sick, boys. Oh man, what a raid wing. So many good memories, man, of Doom CM. Getting that first Doom CM kill. Oh, unnerfed, except for the bombs, I think. No, the bombs weren't fixed either. We just got lucky. Nice. Oh, man.
Yeah.
What a time to be alive, dude.
Our Get Doom insane. CM progression was so painful. So painful. We had a wipe at 0.1% on our, 40th pull.
Oh.
Like, and 40 pulls, like, that's not a lot. Like, that was, like, I don't know, like, a day or two worth. Like, maybe 2 days. So we were like, 40 pulls, okay. We got them to like less than 1%. Like, it took us another 100 pulls after that. We get to 0% after 40 pulls. And then another 100 to 150 pulls to kill after that. Like, so bad. And we had the right strat. The strat that got us to 0.1%. We gave up on it too fast.
Oh no.
And other people who vetoed my call misdiagnosed what the problem was and tried to change the comp to like do it, and it just made it harder for us. So like, basically the long story short was, I go, look guys, we need to be playing builds that allow us to ignore the boss and just focus on the echo. So simple, easy to play builds, right? Like, no complicated DPS rotation needed. So everyone, all the DPS were playing Condi Warriors is what I had a switch to. And it worked because you can play. And at that time, Condi Warrior basically camped Longbow.
Nice.
Like, you did. So it was super easy. And our DPS actually went up because people weren't like going down at all.
Not getting
Condi Warriors unkillable. And it was like, and people could like keep one eye on the echo and still keep the rotation going because you're only pressing a few buttons. It worked.
Value.
But then we had a couple people that like would find creative ways to die every pull. And then you'd get to the final phase with only 7 or 8 people and you would wipe at 0.1%. And so the people would be like, we need more DPS. And really what it was is, we need the 2 or 3 people that randomly die every pull to not die so that they're there at 10% and we could still kill with the Condi Warriors. And of course we switched to Ellie's because that has more DPS, and it ended up costing us like 100 more pulls of
you get DPS, but you know, you lose the uptime and you get and obviously
DPS,
you're very squishy.
No DPS.
We the kill, we ended up 9-manning it because someone died like a minute into the fight, and we had been wiping so much that of course I was just like, fuck it, we're keeping going. We're not gonna GG now because the pre-event is so cancerous that we were like, whatever, we'll just keep going with 9. And we ended up killing it and basically got the free carry there for that person.
Yeah. Oh man. Wing 5 was certainly something to see. And of course, relatively recently, well, I suppose it got said twice, actually. They said that Wing 5 is kind of going to be the peak difficulty, right? And then it very recently, Jonah said on stream, so I guess it's okay to say this, that there's never going to be anything as hard as Wing 5, let alone Doom CM in the game again, which is sad. And that's why we're not going to talk about that, because this is a PMA stream. It's fucking high energy. Feels fucking good, man. Okay, nice. Very good memes. Very good memes, my friends. Do we have anything else to talk about in terms of the history of the game? I think we're pretty caught up.
We can talk about Scion Storm Gaming.
I have a couple of anecdotes that we could throw.
I think we've got time for a few anecdotes. You know, just tease the chat.
We could have had the opportunity to. We could have aborted Snow Crows when they were first created. We could have. So, at that time, EU was hard trash. I'm not going to lie. EU was terrible in these days. 2012, like December of 2012, EU was terrible. People, they didn't even know how to kill Loopy. Like, honestly, didn't know how to kill Loopy. They didn't even know you could use feedback on his barrage and phase him. So, at that point, the founders of Define, which later went on to become Snow Crows, was Shadius and Kreml. And Shadius and Kreml applied to join DNT and said, hey, if we get in, we'll transfer to NA and join with you guys because we want to do what you're doing. And we were like, these guys are good enough because they gave us like sample videos of them like playing. Like these guys are well good enough. They could easily be in. But just the way time zones work, like it was like, well, you guys are going to be playing like the middle of the day for us, and most of us are going to be either at work or at school. And so it's going to be you playing with your own crew anyway. So you might as well stay on EU and start your own thing. So they did. And they started Define, which went on to become Snow Crows. But if we just said, yeah, come transfer to NA, it'll be great. Then there would have never been a Snow Crows.
Holy shit.
So
there you have it. That's pretty intense right there. That's a good meme. That's a little tidbit of history, the lesser known history of Guild Wars 2.
There was a gentleman that was around that I thought about recently, and I think that was the first person in the game that actually really wanted to like actually kill me. Is because he just couldn't stand up to the trolling on the official forums. I just had to give him a shout out because he would talk about how irrelevant and useless and stupid I was, etc. And I just want to say, bruh.
Okay.
I don't even fucking play this game anymore. Yeah. And I'm here with Mighty Teapot, the giant E celebrity that he is.
Oh yeah. Oh yeah. That's big right there. But I'll tell you what, I think that kind of concludes our trip down memory lane, unless I'm mistaken. I think that's about it, right, guys?
No, that's probably it.
I think that's about it for memory lane. So I'll tell you what, I just want to give a quick shout out. We're not going to talk about JP. We're not doing that trash, actually. Go watch PewDiePie's fucking video. Oh, bag of one. Holy shit.
I remember bag. Yeah. See, Teapot. Yeah. So Teapot's in a position that he can actually now believe me when I call Bagawan a hack fraud, because I think he's actually seen the light a little bit, huh?
Yeah, I've seen some interesting things. I'll give you that may or may not be related to things that will be happening soon.
Yo, I just want to put it out there. I would never endorse using one of these things, but if someone could get me a version of Arc DPS with build inspect that I could have for research purposes only.
Yeah.
Because I mean, I would never use it, but I want to like for research purposes only the code. So if someone could get me that, so doable. I could do some research on it, some scientific analysis, that would be great.
Well, in that case, guys, I just want to give a quick shout out. We'll keep it short this time for Teton, because I know you guys are itching for this. But I'll tell you what, guys, if you want to get your friends, okay, this is probably the time. The trailer is about to be unveiled, my friends. But first of all, guys, I've got to give a big shout out to Nike and Brazil for coming on here. Thank you guys very much. If you have any words for us, now is the time.
Anyway. Mm.
Do you want to shill? Like, is there any shilling going on? Do you want to
meme
videos? No.
Nah. I have a video I'm working on that's not necessarily Guild Wars 2 related, though Guild Wars 2 will come up, and it's about different theories of game balance across. I'll have a bunch of different games as examples of how the developers approach game balance in that game, and how Anet does, and how some other games do, and you can see how there's pros and cons to every type of the different types of game balance and what it means for the game. So that should be fun. So stay tuned for that.
Oh, there you go. So that's, you know, you can just find Nike on YouTube. Very, very easy. Nike GW2 will find that search. And of course, Brazil. Well, Brazil will be back for the ERP, but not much of a presence these days on the content creation front. He's kind of moved away from all of that. He's too busy doing more important things, like shoving stuff up his ass, I guess.
Sometimes, yeah.
Yeah.
The ERP will be my last appearance.
Oh man, that's one reason to not miss it, that's for sure.
Yeah. So like I don't think I've ever come out and say that I'm quitting, because I knew that like I'll probably come back and like poke my feet in and do stuff like this from time to time. But like after ERP, like it's finalized. There will be no more Guild Wars 2 in any capacity in my life.
Wow. Okay. Well,
I think I'm one of the few people to beat Guild Wars 2.
Whoa. Yeah, you won? Oh, no, you definitely did. That's for sure. So, all that remains to be said now, ladies and gentlemen, okay, is thank you so much for watching this tea time, okay? Those on YouTube, you don't need to watch the trailer here because, you know, it's going to be on YouTube anyway by the time you see this.
It'll be on the front page of r/MMORPG.
Oh, I hope so. We need to get someone get that fucking X post going, guys, because prepare yourself.
Yeah. I'm not going to say that we should bandwagon and upvote that to the front of MMORPG, but if you think it's relevant content, you probably should upvote it.
I think, yeah, that's something that you could do. But all that remains to be said, ladies and gentlemen, is thank you so much for watching this tea time. Follow, subscribe, everyone here.
Show the thing.